gotta go back, do it all again. When we were fine living the life out in Cali, I was so sad, just wondering why I think about you whenever I get lonely. I've tried to erase us, but nothing compares to what we do. Let's go.
disco fries blowing out your mother speakers, period. That's what it is. Disco fries in the building, and you know something? It's going to get done to you right now. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. Yeah, it happens right now. The disco fries are on the set. Let's go.
Yo.
Yo.
DJ Augie. Liftoff debut today. Yeah, there
yeah,
it is.
Yeah, he sent this one a while back. Wait. Oh, man. Yo.
Letting this drop play out without talking. Yeah, big one here.
Yeah.
Got to work on this one. Go ahead.
I was going to say it. It finished my track special. I think this might have been the first one that Augie came to us with. And it sounded great. Helped polish it up. And that was how it all started.
Liftoff debut right here. Shout out to DJ Augie putting in work. It's crazy. I'd say he was on... He's been on almost every live stream dropping records, so...
Yeah.
Shout out to him and Radio Dave in the chat. Two hard workers right there.
Yo, I think everyone's in like crunch time mode right now.
Yeah, I would say so. If I get one more auto reply, like if I had a dollar for every auto reply that I got from Wednesday on.
I know, right? And we got such a crazy week next week, and there's so much stuff that I'm trying to get done, and today's the last day that the kids are in school. So I know it's like... Oh, it's gonna be rough. I got my COVID booster on Wednesday, and I was laid out all day yesterday, so I didn't get like shit done.
Oh, did it fuck you up?
Enough that I like was not productive.
Yeah, gotcha. Yeah, you got it, man. I see you in the chat. So you guys might have seen that we had a little new intro there, especially for the holidays. We will be doing our Disco Fries, Fried, Fam, Festivus. God damn, that's a mouthful of words.
You never say it out loud.
Yeah, that'll be next week. We're going to do a snack chat with Record Shop on Tuesday, and their holiday party is going on Tuesday. And then on Wednesday, 8 p.m. Eastern, we'll be doing Fried, Fam, Festivus. We got giveaways. We got merch. We got music. We got drinks. And it's free. You could just sign up at this link that I'm gonna drop in the chat.
Yeah.
And
RSVP and it's free.
RSVP and it's free. I like that motto. Let me see. I should have had this link ready again, and I didn't.
It's hard, like getting all this stuff ready right before this. I finally automated this thing where I can just like type something in and like all the programs I need pop up.
Because of course
there's
you
like
did.
10 different things that I pull up every time.
That and I close about 15 things.
Yeah.
I always have like Photoshop, Motion, iMovie, all that shit. Anyway, if you guys need to RSVP, if you haven't yet, you just jump to that link. You can RSVP. That's where you'll get access to the event. It's a private event, but it's free. So come hang out. It's Wednesday, the 22nd at 8 p.m.
Yep.
Awesome. So we thought about a new segment today called Music News.
Do you want to?
We could jump into the... Save it for the end?
Yeah.
Let's do that. All right, we're going to save that one for the end. And we're going to jump into our special guest of the day. You want to do the intros?
Yeah, so today's guest is a legend in the scene. Been releasing records since like 96. The first record I could find of his was on Strictly Rhythm in 96. So before house music was even a thought in our minds, Junior Sanchez has been at work, released with all kinds of labels, from Size, Dimmock, Spinning, Stamped, Affected, Nervous, Strictly Rhythm. It goes on and on. He started his own label, Robot, I think back in 2016, but we're going to ask him about that, and continues to this day. And yeah, so let's bring on,
ladies and gentlemen,
Junior Sanchez.
Junior Sanchez. Where is he? There he is. Yo!
What's up, man?
What an intro. What's going on?
How you doing, man?
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
We can.
Fantastic. All right. What an intro, man. Thank you.
Yo, you're like a legend. It's crazy because I've always known your name, but we don't roll in the same circle, so we don't cross each other's paths. But you go back like, shit, it's like 25 years at this point.
Yeah, I've been doing this since I was a sophomore in high school. I had my first record. It's crazy.
That's crazy. Wild.
And a guy looks 25 years old. He doesn't age.
Yeah, I'm aging. I'm aging gracefully, but you know, we all got to play that health game.
Yeah, man.
And revert like who's that? Joe Budden? No, not Joe Budden.
Benjamin Button.
Benjamin Button. I'm like Joe Budden.
That's another word. Man. Yeah, man. So how's this year treated you?
2021's been phenomenal, man. I mean, even the pandemic was. 2020 was challenging. There was a lot of dark times, but a lot of, you know, light, a lot of great things happened from it. For everybody, I'm sure, you know, it was challenging for the world. But 2021 was super progressive and super positive and productive. So it was, you know, nothing really to complain about. I had a baby during COVID. I had a COVID baby.
Congrats.
So
that was crazy. made a shitload of music, made an album, singles, and new management, new agent, all during the pandemic, which is really crazy. While going through a lot of personal shit, you know?
Wow.
Were those moves kind of in motion pre-COVID, or you just were like, this is a good time to refresh?
No, I actually wasn't even thinking about shit. Like, I got, you know, my management came to me and they were like, you know, we've been seeing what you've been doing and, you know, I'm with Little Empire. And they were like, you know, we want to, you know, how would it feel if we manage you? And I was kind of like against kind of management. I've been doing a lot of things, you know, through the course of my career, how when it started, I was with X-Mix, with Armand, Sneak, Felix, and, you know, and Todd Terry. And from then on, I kind of went with AAM, which is Advanced Alternative Media, Mark Bevin. I did a stint when I produced a lot of rock. And from then, I just kind of like managed myself. And then, you know, it just made sense, kind of whole new world. You need, you know, you need a team. Like today is just, it's so crazy. It's so nuts that you have to have, you know, a good team behind you. So it made sense. And then got a new agent and, you know, started implementing all these little, you know, Legos, like, you know, the social media person and that person and this person, all the shit that I never really cared about that you have to now kind of really take into account and just really, you know, be cognitive of it because it's important.
Yeah, it is wild thinking about, like, for how long you've been doing it. Like, there's so much other shit involved in being an artist now compared to even 10 years ago. I mean, like, Nick and I got our start probably, like, 2010 or something like that.
I remember when you guys came out. I've been aware of you guys since day one. You guys are Tommy Sunshine's boys.
Yeah, that's how we met. Yeah, yeah.
That's how we met down in Miami. I feel like one of the not the first year we met, but but it was shortly after we started going to Miami. Tommy introduced us and started making the rounds with him because he knows everybody. So it was like, it was a good way to enter Miami with some records when we could get introduced to all the right people through Tommy. So I definitely want to touch on like. We came to know you as like a DJ producer, but I didn't realize all the other shit you've done in the space. I knew about you and the label and everything, but I'd love to hear like all the things you've been involved with in music outside of just being an artist.
It's funny because I was just doing a podcast with my boy Jason Jordan, who was at Hollywood Records Republic, and he was Hollywood Republic, and he's been. I mean, he's a legend in the game. He's still around, and we were talking and. Man, it went from, you know, releasing records when I was 16, playing in Limelight when I was about 15, 14, Terry Moglia room at the Club USA, signing my first publishing deal in like 99, had Be With You, which was a record of Mercury that came out in the UK, which is a top 40 record. Then, you know, doing the Mongoloids with myself, Daft Punk, Armand, Sneak, you know, that we were like the Wu-Tang of house, and then signed my pub deal and then started producing bands like, the, you know, Katy Perry, Gorillaz, and Morningwood. And a lot of, so when I spoke about it with him, and he comes from that world, he's just like, dude, man, you did Action Reaction, which was on Equal Vision, the same label as Coheed and Cambria. Like, I've dove in so many sectors. That's why, I mean, me and Tommy, you guys don't know that, you know, Felix's record, Kittens of Glitz, Tommy and I did a lot of it, and it was produced in my basement, and it came out on my label Cube, you know, and I licensed it to City Rockers. There's a lot of, I mean, we could be here for a long time and talk about all that shit, but I've been in the culture and always navigated in a way of touching shit that's really, really edgy and sharp and right. And, you know, I've never kind of wanted to venture off in any aspect that was, that I wasn't proud of. Like, everything with me has to be very artistic and very, very authentic. And talking to Jason, it just reminded me of, like, holy shit. Like, there's definitely a lot of different segments of my life that touched on different parts of, you know, my creativity or where I was at the time or what I was into and what was really triggering me to be creative or stay creative or, you know, because this business is, it's, you know, you, I got into it because I love it, not because I wanted to be a DJ or famous or make money. It's because I just had love for making music. When I got into it, you needed to go to a studio, pay for it or buy gear, which wasn't cheap. Mm-hmm. You know, like, you had to buy samplers, a mixer, you know, even pre-computers, like, you know EPS-16s or W30s or workstations. So, like, you really had to invest in this craft. So when I thought about it, I was like, damn, I really must love the art of being a producer and making music, because if not, I wouldn't have done it, you know.
I think it's interesting that you came at it from, like, a creative perspective, because I mean we do a lot of different things in the business, from publishing to you know, we're involved with Record Shop with NFTs, and we do sync, and there's all types of stuff we do, but it's very, like, at least from my perspective, it's very, like, deliberate. Like, from a business perspective, this makes sense to add to kind of the pie of what we have going on. But I find it interesting that you approached all of it just from a creative perspective, like, I wanna do XYZ in the business because creatively that'll be cool to do.
Yeah, and I think that all stemmed from, because I never thought of it in a way of monetizing. Like, I never exploited myself and I said, let's do this, let's do that. Mm-hmm. We just did everything. I come from a school where nobody said, do this and you're gonna make this. If you do this and take this step, you're gonna reach there. It was kind of like, it was purely art driven, like, purely because I wanted to, man, the first time I stepped into a studio, or the first time I made a record, I was addicted to the process of it. The first time I started DJing at Limelight or Club USA, Palladium, I was addicted to the culture, the underground. Like, going from NASA at the shelter and hearing, like, you know, Soul Slinger and drum and bass, and then going to Sound Factory Bar and hearing Little Louis Vega. Like, that was my shit. Like, I came from that school where I went to the rave, listened to the, you know, a lot of techno, and Sven Vath, and then listen to Louis. I'm from New Jersey. I'm from Newark. So that soulful shit was already in me. But I also was young enough to be like, okay, I know this. I love Kerry Chandler, but I also want to hear some Dave Clark. Like, that was just how I lived, man. And I also wanted to hear hip hop. I also wanted to go to Sheets and Pillows. Like, I also wrote graffiti. I was a kid of the culture, like a kid, like, I guess what they call hype beast kids today. That was me growing up in New York, just loving shit that was subculture. No matter what it was, if it was dope, I was in it. I dove in it because it was fresh.
I'd be curious of, like, how, because I was super young then, obviously from New Jersey as well, but, like, really curious on the overlap between house music culture and hip hop in New Jersey and New York at that time, because now it's like, you know, there's huge overlap, like EDM artists doing records with hip hop artists. It's just the nature of the beast right now.
Interesting topic. So I had this conversation. I've seen the progressions come together and to come back. So when I was growing up, like literally growing up, even before making records, every hip hop artist had a club track on their album. They call them club, not house records, club records. Special Ed, this is for the club scene. Moni Love, Grandpa's Party, Jungle Brothers, I'll House You, for example. KY Stomp. Queen Latifah, Come Into My House, How Do I Love Thee? I can go on and on and on and on. Tropical Quest, Black is Black. I can keep on going. Like, everybody had a club joint on their album. And I spoke to a lot of different people about this, even Andre Harrell, God rest his soul. One day came to my house, I was working on a project with him, and I was like, yo, what happened? Why did Black culture completely fucking, excuse me, can I curse here?
Yeah, of course.
Like, why did Black culture completely disregard and diss house music or club music? And it was the gay stigma. The fact that it was a gay culture attached to that, you know, even though hip hop came from Chicago and there was a lot of that going on, they culturally are different than New York and stuff. But essentially, as hip hop got bigger, they wanted to disattach anything that was had a stigma attached to homosexuality. And that's where the divide came. And then what happened? Our music became bigger in Europe. That's where everyone started to have success. Europe embraced it, which is fantastic. But, you know, American dance music was novelty. LaBouche, Be My Lover, Real McCoy, yeah. Blah, 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 blah. Nothing was really consistent. But back in the 90s, you can have CC Peniston and Crystal Waters, all legitimately great dance records that exploded and blew up that were on the charts. But then that dissipated. And then a lot of dance people they had success, like CC Peniston, for example, beautiful, an amazing woman, great friend. Had great, finally, it was a classic, but then everybody wanted to make R&B because they knew that the labels didn't take house music seriously. So all these artists that broke and made dance records wanted to become R&B artists. And then America got flooded with European dance music, which was all the, you know, the Arista days, Hosh Greeley and Clive Davis and Real McCoy and Armand would remix that stuff. But all that stuff was considered novelty. We didn't take it serious. Or American dance labels didn't take that shit seriously. Up until David Guetta and that time and that whole situation where now EDM happened and it was still a little bit iffy. I mean, I did skip. There was a long gap, but that's kind of what ushered in. The first song I heard that I knew it was changing pre-David was Sexy Back. When I heard Sexy Back and I heard that record with him and Justin Timberlake, I'm like, okay, there's a shift happening. The same way when I heard Smells Like Teen Spirit for the first time, I'm like, there's a shift happening. Like, you felt it. There's only two times I ever felt that shit in my life. Was Smells Like Teen Spirit, and saw that video, I'm like, this is crazy. Because I knew the band on Sub Pop pre that record, but that particular record and that video changed everything. Like, it was like I woke up one day, it was Poison, and then the next day we woke up, everybody
was just flannel. Everybody.
Fucking nuts.
Yeah.
And that's when I heard Sexy Back. I was like, wait, it's changing. Shit is changing. Something's happening. And that's when, you know, we had this whole, the EDM thing went on for a long time. I mean, we all played a part of it. You know, I look at our culture as like a giant pixel. Like, you know, let's say electronic music is an amazing pixel of one piece of art. And we all are little pixels, you know. That play a role in it. You guys played a role in it as well. We continue to do that, and we continue to add to this, whatever this picture is of this amazing piece of art. But yeah,
do you think with like 60,000 songs coming out every day, do you think those moments are still possible to happen, or do you think there's too much noise?
Over 65,000 plus songs uploaded a day on Spotify alone, on one platform, and over 50% of that is dance music.
Yeah.
Oh, those stats. That is absolutely mind-boggling and incredible. To answer your question in a quick manner, yes, I think it's harder. It's virtually impossible. But also, I think there's a lot of devalue in music today. Not just in dance music, but in all forms, in pop and hip hop and everything. I mean, it's just I'm not saying where we come from or where you guys come from is better than now. It's not. It's just, it's all relevant, right? To my daughter, Billie Eilish is as relevant as, you know, Sade to me. You know what I'm saying? So,
right.
But I think it's the industry that's taking it, that's making it disposable or less tangible. Like the fact that we're making records that are 2 minutes long and we have to follow an algorithm. The fact that labels are dictating a sound to the artist. Like, artists can't be themselves. They're like, oh, I gotta make a record because I gotta, you know, fit a label sound. So now I gotta make it sound like this. So now an artist aren't being artists. They're just doing something to fit somewhere. They're not being creative. They're not like letting loose and just, you know, this whole thing that we're doing was, we're supposed to be artists, be producers, be songwriters, be like, you can't, you know, paint the same painting as somebody else and call yourself an artist. And that's what's happening. Yep. Label, you know, A&Rs, some A&Rs and some labels are forcing people to be in a box. And it's kind of fucking up our culture because you don't really hear Homeworks. You don't hear Daft Punk.
Yeah.
You don't hear Plastic Man. You don't hear Richie Hawtin. You don't hear Jeff Mills. Or you don't hear, and I'm, you know, not just those type of records, but all across the board, you know? And that's fucking shit up because now they're like, oh, you got to make a, in order to really get a lot of plays or be playlisted, you got to make Piano House. So if you got pianos on there, you got a chance. And then what happens? You get flooded with 30,000 Piano House records.
Yep. Right.
And they all sound the same and nothing is different. There's no originality. And that's, that fucks shit up. It, you know, so to me, that fucks the Matrix up or that fucks the metaverse up. Whatever though you want to call it today, that's what's fucking shit up. So,
well, it's also the price point of entry is super cheap, which is great. Yeah. It's accessible for more people.
The technology is accessible. Everyone has the tools. Yeah.
Yeah. You're right. 100%. I mean, that's, you know, technology's changed the game exponentially. I was talking to a friend of mine yesterday. I mean, my studio is condensed from hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of outboard gear to my new M1 fucking Pro Max Mac to, you know, a screen, good monitors, and, you know, I still have my front end, but I mean, it's condensed to my laptop.
Yeah.
And now it's not a fact of you needing it, so you wanted it. You want a mini Moog, it's because you want it. You don't need it. You want a 1083 or a 1073 or you know, a compressor, you don't need it because you want it, you know? Yeah. So yeah, technology has changed that. So there's a lot of kids that are making records. So, but I think that there's a balance. It's the industry is creating the monsters, and the kids aren't, you know, it's instant gratification. They're not doing things for the reasons of artistic. They want to have a moment, whether it be a TikTok moment or a moment on the Beatport 100 or whatever it is, the intentions are wrong. You know, that's just my opinion.
I want to get into Web3 in a second because I saw your Instagram profile picture and I got to touch on that. But just kind of off of this, Boys Noise tweeted yesterday, basically my videos aren't compatible with social media because they're either too long or the type of content it is. And so he can't promote his music, and his music is not compatible with streaming services to get playlisted because the style is not easy to define. Also, the algorithm doesn't like that the intros are longer than 3 minutes. So that's why he's exploring Web3. But basically what he's saying is everything I'm doing from the videos to the music isn't doing shit as a result of the algorithms and everything. And this is Boys Noise, who has a massive following. I mean, done records with Skrillex and everything.
Yeah, it's super influential.
Yeah, and that's my boy. Alex is my boy. I know Alex for a long time. We go way back. But Yoni is good at, so just, you know, so here we, listen, if we wanted to play the names game, I could, you know, splurt out a lot of shit, but nobody gives a fuck. Like, nobody, like, Yoni is good as your last record. I could have made a record with Skrillex 5 years ago. What does that do to, what, it means nothing right now. Nothing today.
Right.
Just really doesn't fucking matter. So, as artists, I think, you know, there's a differentiator. There's two different type of artists. People that really do this they want to be an artist. They want to create. And people are just doing this for the moment. They want to, like these Island Boys motherfuckers, like Island Boy, blah, 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 like whatever that is.
Yeah,
it's incredible to me that that happens and that there's people out there that co-sign that shit. And even if it's funny, it ain't funny because all it does is really fuck up what we work so hard to achieve in this. Listen, there's always going to be shit and there's always going to be music. There's always going to be yin and yang. Not everybody could be the fucking coolest shit in the world. Not everybody could be Daft Punk because then that'll be whack, right? There has to be a balance, but we have to, there has to be some sort of line as creators and artists that we go, whoa, 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 whoa. Like we can't let, you know, like remember what that shit happened with, that dude that won the Grammy that wore the fucking spacesuit, or that he got nominated, Al Washer.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Years ago. Yeah, yeah.
That crazy shit happened. Mm-hmm. He just came in, joined Grammy 365, yep. manipulated that community, somehow got nominated for electronic, yeah. you know, dance album. Like, who the fuck was this guy?
Right.
Right? That was an uproar. Oh my God, that we can't let that happen. That's wrong. But then we co-sign shit like that and disrupt our culture even more. I think we're in a weird time. So I do value like the shit that's happening with NFTs and Web3 and even, you know, the notion of a metaverse of a different, you know, territorial space for us to live in and build, because I think it gives more artists control, but at the same time, people are monetizing. It's a game. It's the Wild Wild West, and it's a fucking gold rush of craziness. You know how many NFT DMs I get a day?
Oh yeah,
it's driving crazy.
Yeah,
and it's a joke. It's a Ponzi thing, you know. And for people that don't, this NFT spam DM is the old, you know, oh, you want to be like, you know, well, take care of your Instagram and do this.
We'll repost your SoundCloud and
yeah, whatever that shit is. That's the new game.
Yeah.
I'm like, this shit is crazy. It's absolutely insane.
Yeah, it's nuts how quickly that happens, where it's like, here's this brand new like outlet for artists where they don't have to compromise on their artistic vision, whatever. It gives them all these possibilities, and already people like immediately jump on that side of like, how can we exploit this? How are we making a quick buck off of it? But I think that's just, I mean, that's the way we kind of, on some level, you have to accept that's the way it is and look beyond that to what are the possibilities? What can we do with this that allow for, you know, freedom as an artist, and you're not having to make these compromises to make a living doing what you love.
Yeah, and we're still learning, and we're figuring this out. Like, this is a whole new spectrum, and nobody's got this is what we're in right now is our Napster moment in 1997, yep. Whatever the fuck that was. Like,
for sure,
when labels were like, "What's this shit? We're scared of this. We hate this." Metallica, sue them. You know, what is an MP3? What's the compression? Oh, it sounds good. Really, it sounds like shit. We didn't know that yet until years later. Like, you know, like just figuring all this shit out. It's a whole new. I can't even say world. It's a whole new fucking, you know, Matrix is coming out. Like, what a perfect time for the Matrix to come out.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. I do think that there's an opportunity, though. Like, the labels seem to have noted what they fucked up about Napster and embracing that. And there definitely seems to be more willingness for corporations on this one to jump in. Like, the fact that Disney jumped in right away says a lot.
Nike, Adidas, but there's also a lot of younger people in the labels now. Like, if you look at a lot of these executives, there's 21-year-olds, 22-year-olds, 23-year-olds. I'm like, holy shit, that never happened. Like, I would walk into Capitol and there was like, you know, 50-something-year-olds, you know, or 60. And then, I mean, motherfucker, Clive Davis was still around forever. He wouldn't retire. Like, he was like, I ain't leaving. I'm here. I know what's up. Yep. Like, everything, it was, it's, I mean, even though those are real record men, but there's also a generation that came in between them and now that were just suits from universities going, okay, what's the bottom line? What's the numbers? Yeah. What's the, you know, what's the ROIs? What's the, like, you know, there was no real sense of like, even A&Rs were scared. They had artistic integrity. They wanted to do the right thing, but they had the job on the line. So they're like, okay, how do we do it? But people are still doing that today. Now, but what the difference is, they're looking at algorithms and going, does this fit this algorithm? Does this fit one fucking platform? Like, it's incredible to me that one platform dominates the world right now. It's like, you know, radio was huge, but at least you had channels like, you know, 97, 103. You had different bands of frequencies. Now you got one place that's like, ah, we're the boss. We, you know,
well, and we always talk about it on here, but the fact that, and we love Spotify, like, I love it as a consumer. It's convenient. I love it as an artist. We do really well on there.
Love the concept of Spotify, right? Mm-hmm. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go for it.
No. I was just going to say, but it's amazing to me how much of it lives in its own silo. Like, you could have a record that's 100 million streams on Spotify, and
doesn't mean you're getting booked for shows. It
doesn't mean shit. Like, if you get booked off of that, like, people might not show up. Like, that has nothing to do with what's actually happening in the fan space.
Yeah,
you're absolutely right, 100%. So, like, listen, I'm not mad at Daniel Elk. I'm not like angry that he created this monstrosity and then he's making, you know, like we can't get mad at somebody inventing something and then, you know, the world, you know, we monetize it. I get it.
Yeah.
But I also feel when you're in that position of power and you're in that position, it's a little bit deeper because, you know, he, you know, when Spotify first came out, I remember when it first happened and they gave me a free account. Like I got it. I'm like, what is this shit? I'm streaming. Like it was really weird. Cause you know, like everything else, like in 2012, when somebody came with Bitcoin, I was like, no, right. I mean, yeah. Because we just don't understand. Right. And that's what happens. Right. What we don't understand, we get scared of and we tend to like, nah. So anyway, Spotify to me is like when he had to negotiate with the labels and figure out how the fuck he's going to do this. That's when he kind of lost a lot of like his, I think, control, because he could have been that savior that said, we have this platform, we're going to make billions of dollars, but so are artists. Like, we're going to be artist friendly. Mm-hmm. It doesn't take a lot at all to be artist friendly.
Right.
It doesn't, man. Like, everyone can eat. Like, this shit is crazy. If Spotify wanted to, they should say, hey, we want to put, you know, you can sell NFTs off here. They can modify this whole shit to go, we want to give the artists more. They don't, because at the end of the day, what's the bottom line? They don't need to. But right. We have the power. If we all artists say, you know something, we don't want to use that platform anymore. We don't want to use that as distribution. We can use this, do that. We have the power to shut it off. Like Instagram, they built an evaluation based upon us. We are the human beings. We are the batteries, the matrix fucking batteries. If we all went like this, all of us at once and went shh, and took this shit off, they wouldn't exist. We just don't realize how much power we have.
Yeah.
Amen to
that.
But
if we unify, we really have the power.
Yeah. You know? Well, that's interesting to point out. Like, I wonder if Spotify, I mean, they have to be having conversations about it, but like, even from like a, I don't know, like a PR standpoint, like what a difference that would make if they started making like changes to supporting artists, like even small changes, I feel like would go such a long way, but there's really like none of that.
Look at the merch deal.
Even if they gave a couple of cents more to artists, you know how much difference that would make to artists' lives? Let's do the minuscule shit. Let's say they're, you know, they're a superpower. Like, you know, even if they said, you know, we want to give back, let's give everybody else 3 more cents. Fuck. I mean, it sounds ridiculous, but that makes a huge difference.
Huge. Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. why not do that? Because they don't want to do that. They can. You know?
Right. But I mean, look at to both of your points. Like, when they announced that whole integration with Shopify and artists could sell merch via their page, like, people flipped out. They were like, this is fucking amazing. This is, like, the best thing to happen.
Right, but that's probably, like, the easiest thing for them like, how much work did that take for them to put that together relative to how good it looks for them as a company? And there's, like, a million things they could do in that space that would make it.
The other thing that fascinates me is that all of the bad press goes towards Spotify. Yeah. Meanwhile, Apple is like a marginal fractional cent more in royalty, and it doesn't get any shit because they just have a marginal leg up.
Yeah, but you're right. But the Apple, Amazon, Deezer, like they don't have much of the market share. You know, like they really don't. Like I love Apple. I don't understand anything else but Apple in my world, and I don't even have an Apple Music account.
I'm the same way.
Right.
Everything in my house really is Apple, don't. And I don't listen to Apple Music.
I don't listen to Apple
Why
Music.
Why is that?
Everything is Spotify because we're conditioned. We are conditioned to live in this world of convenience, and convenience for us is Spotify.
Right.
You know,
it's like, it's why credit card companies and razor companies market to like college kids and like eighth graders.
On that campus, right.
Yeah. Like once you create, it's some kind of metric. Like once you start with a chick, right, you're never going to change razors, or they have some kind of data around 80% of people don't change razors.
Yeah.
That's like that's exactly what we're dealing with streaming. It's really hard to move people over to another platform.
Because you don't want to learn a new thing. We're so inundated. Like, I'll tell you right now, what I'm like, perfect example. Crypto or NFTs, for example, like buying them, whether you use MetaMask or this platform, that you can't buy this NFT because you have to download this one, or this can't transfer. It's just like, what the fuck? Or you got to get a Discord and do that. It's really fucking complicated.
Yeah.
And you have to understand and navigate through different shit. Like, I was just talking to a friend of mine. I was paying him for you know, for this NFT that he got me because I couldn't get on that platform fast
enough.
And I had to pay him back. So I was like, okay, so what do you use? I use this. Or well, I use that. So now I got to download this to transfer that. Because it's just like, damn. And I get it. Like companies like MoonPay now and, you know, there's open, like there's a lot. But we need to aggregate to one place where people can kind of feel safe and trust. There's just too much shit going on. That's scary because there's too many platforms where shit could just kind of disappear and go away, you know? Yeah. And people are scared to learn new things. Like to me, I'm like, how many fucking apps do I have to download and put my life into, my information into? How many more things do I have to learn how to navigate in because every language is different, right?
Right.
It's just, that's annoying, you know?
Yeah.
It's like reading Roland manuals in English. It's just translated from Japanese and it makes no sense.
So are you are you actively collecting at the moment? Like what's your, like how did you, let's go back, like how did you get into the NFT space and like what's been the most appealing thing there for you? What are you just like kind of still feeling it out? What's going on there?
No, I think it's fantastic. I think it's about knowing it's no different than real estate or buying gear, like, or you know, like, you know that if you buy a 1073 or if you buy a you know, a real Neve 1083, but or you bought a clone from Wonder Audio, I can tell you that your investment is going to go better on a real, Neve. So my point in saying it's like, it's about what you buy, what's around it, what's aggregating it, what's pushing it, what's the hype, how many users are, or you know, like, how, you know, like a crypto thing, what's in circulation, how many people are using, like you can't just. This NFT shit is funny because all these DMs are popping up and they're just scams and kids are just buying it thinking they're going to make millions of dollars. But meanwhile, they're nothing. They're just live in ethos. They make no sense. So I first noticed NFT from my boy, Thank You X. And this was during pre-pandemic. He did a drop. Well, I didn't know it was a drop. I learned it was a drop because when I asked him, he's like, man, I've been doing this shit. Like I actually know him as an artist, like a painter. Mm. And he's married to a friend of mine, Eden, who's a vocalist that she was in a band that I produced years ago. What was the band? I can't remember the name, but it'll come to me. It was three girls. But I asked him, like, he made this image of like a lifeguard stand in Miami that was dripping paint. And I'm like, yo, what cool visual. I mean, get visuals. I mean, Eric Prydz makes dope visuals. He never did an NFT. I'm like, what is that? He goes, that's my art. I'm like, I get it, okay. But like a digital art. And then, and that's why I learned what NFT was and fungible tokens and this and that. It lives in this space and you have this. It's not a real physical object, but you own it. And it's, you know, backed up by a blockchain, which is, I understand blockchain because I did something with this European company called Utopia for a long time. And I was president of the label at that, in that stage years ago. And we were going to pay royalties to artists via blockchain. Mm. So I got that, but now there's a whole new thing, the art and this, and you can, you know, it's, so that's when I first started diving in and I had to wrap my head around it because it's something to learn. It's a, it's a new language. It's like, what? Okay. And then shit just took off. Like during the pandemic, it kind of, you know, slowed. And then that blow shit happened. I was like, what the fuck is this guy? What just happened? I'm like, what the fuck?
Dude, I was on the Clubhouse. I feel like this was like a moment in history now, thinking back to it, because of how much of an event it was. But I was on the Clubhouse when he was just in there talking through the auction. It was happening.
As people were bidding,
Yeah, as people were bidding. And I was like, this is a fucking moment in history that like I'll never forget because it's the start of it. I mean, obviously the tech existed. People were already in the space. But that's one of those like, holy tipping
crossed over to
like Nirvana. It was Smells Like Teen Spirit moment. Like,
right.
Like, it was that. It was that moment. It was the moment that was like, oh shit, something is happening here that is changing the world.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So yeah, that. So you experienced that moment. You experienced me watching, you know, Nirvana Smells Like Teen Spirit video, going, yeah, oh shit, sure. This is different. So I told, but that was a moment. I wasn't on that Clubhouse, but I was on Clubhouse early during that time. But I wasn't on that particular feed. But I remember even my boy Matt Medved. He was like, before NFT now, this is like him in between gigs of working. Mm-hmm. He's like, I don't know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna do this, blah, blah, blah. But next thing you know, he's just 6 months ago or 7 months ago started NFT now, and here we are. I'm like, God damn. And it's real. You just got to know how to navigate it, know what paths to take, know what to, it's understanding art. Anyone could just buy art, but if you want to buy art, from an unknown, or you gotta do your research and know where it's coming from, what's behind it, who it is, and what the combination of the collaboration it is with, whether it be, you know, it's a recipe right now. And, yeah. And, I'm into it because I like art and I love the fact that we can integrate, you know, the visual aspect, the audible music, this is a great thing for us. So I dig that, but it's also fucking shady and scary because right. There's a lot of crazy shit happening, you know?
Yeah, I think I feel like people look at it two different ways. There are people that look at it strictly as like an investment and a way to make money. But then I think there's, from an artist and from a fan perspective, it's just a new platform to connect with artists in a closer way, which is kind of what we've really resonated with. I don't know if you're familiar with Record Shop. Todd Terry did a drop on there. What, Nick? 2 months ago now.
Yeah. About
How did it do? How did it do?
Really well. It sold out. Crazy. Like nothing. It sold out in under a half hour. It was, he killed it.
And what it's were the like, margins, you know?
What's that?
Like, where were the margins? Like, what did they sell? Like, what did each?
And I forget what the packs cost. Finn.
Packs were like 10 or 15 bucks, something like that. And
how many packs were there? I'm trying to understand that particular drop.
I can't remember, but yeah. So there's basically the way the site works is there's a primary drop of a pack. They'll mint, I don't know what that one was, but let's say
5,555 at 15 bucks.
So that's okay. that's a good mint count, right? And then like in that pack was like three or four cards, probably like two from Todd and maybe two from somebody that was on his label or somebody else associated on Record Shop, whatever. Once people get those cards, there's a secondary marketplace. So you can go and trade those cards, and then the artist gets a 9% royalty on each sale. So if a $2 card goes to 100 and you sell it for 100, artist gets $9 off that 100.
Got it. Yeah. So my question is, does anybody know what it has? Has it resold? Has anybody resold it for?
Oh yeah. I know it's trading. I don't know what the exponential amount is, but I know they've been like trading and resale.
So this is where we're at. Like, that's great. That's an amazing thing. So what Todd did on Record Shop, he minted what, 5,500, that's something crazy, 15 bucks. That's awesome. That's great. So I don't know what the split was between Record Shop and him, and then they resell. But that's also like playing the stock market on a small scale.
Yes,
like,
sir.
You know, it's not nothing crazy. People have their delusions of grandeur where they're like, oh, this shit's going to resell for, you know, 1,000 times more or whatever the case may be.
Right.
This is where we're, you know, it's volatile. When you think about it, it is investing. It is, you know, buying, you know, stock at a certain price and hoping, you know, it fucking goes up. But in theory, will it make you rich? Probably not. So you got to, you either do this for the investment purpose, but if you do investment purposes, you got to make the right investments and go, is this going to explode? And we can't predict this shit. Nobody can. But sometimes you can. Like, you look at the Ape Yacht Club or whatever, that shit, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I first saw that and I saw, you know, the people that were involved in it in the back end, like Austin Rose and all these, I'm like, this shit is going to go.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And it's going to go hard. And if you can get your hands on one, it's going to fucking explode. But that's the thing. If you're not in certain circles, if you're not in this space, or if you're not like, you don't have a bot ready to go.
Yeah, you have to be at the front. You have to be at the front. Otherwise, it's too late.
You can't. There's no bandwidth for you to get it. There's no space. You're in a fucking club like this. You're trying to get out. The fire's on. You're trying to get to one door over there.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
not like there's one door here and here and here and you can go. There's that. And so that's what's crazy about this is, like, if you don't understand and you're not in, and it's no different than a sneaker drop or a pair of sneakers.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, if you don't fucking have a bot ready to go, you're not. You don't have a chance to invest in this thing at a small scale, because we all know this: to invest and win, you need to invest big and a lot of money.
Right.
So you buying a little bit of a stock and it grows, it's not making you anything. You need to buy a shitload.
Yeah.
For you to make a really, really tangible return.
So I think what's been most interesting, like with Todd's thing, what was cool to see is like people collected like a set of those cards, right? And then if they completed the set, he did an airdrop. So he and all the cards had like him telling a backstory about a record. So I think what was cool about it, like at least from a super fan perspective,
that is cool, actually.
Yeah, if you were going on there and getting a collectible and you were spending $15 for his cards, you were getting a track you never heard, you were getting a video about that record that Todd was talking through, and like right. Some of them had like studio breakdowns and stuff like that. But it was just, it gives layers to a record versus it just being like, here's a song on Spotify or Apple and that's it. It makes it like a three-dimensional yeah. experience.
Which is awesome. And I love that. And I'm going to look into that. I think that's fucking great. I mean, I got stories out my ass, but that shit's amazing. But also, but there's a ceiling in that. You need to be a Todd Terry fan.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
And you know, so there is a ceiling. So if I did it, you know, people got to give a fuck about me. And I always say this, fame is a matter of perspective. You either know me or you don't. You know me, you care. You don't know me, you don't give a shit. That's just how it is.
Right.
You can't walk around thinking like, damn, I'm Junior Sanchez. I'm going to put out a fucking NFT and everybody's going to buy this shit. Like, yeah, if I did that with an artist, a collaborative artist that was bigger than me and he had a fan base, one could outweigh the other, but it has to be strategic. So I get it. I mean, I love it. I think it's fantastic. I think we're in this like, way we're in some gold rush right now and people just
yeah
in there fucking with the pots going like we got something yeah. okay no and we're gonna figure it out and it's yeah. gonna stabilize and it's gonna be something once we really figure this out and you know understand the bigger ethos and even like this whole meta like people buying land in the metaverse where your avatar needs a fucking haircut and you're a bar like you know like yeah, it's yeah. just gonna get crazy. You know,
yo, I just read that Meta, Facebook, is investigating a woman said she was groped in the metaverse.
Yeah, and, like, I saw those headlines.
I don't understand stop. What that fucking stop. Means.
I don't. I don't.
Stop. are you serious? That's real? That's a real article?
That's a real article.
Yeah. I didn't read the article. I just saw the headline and I moved along.
But I like, that's where we're headed.
Max Headroom? Max Headroom got to be the fucking the perv. You guys know who Max Headroom is?
Probably no.
So back in the day, looked it up real quick. Back in the day, like Pepsi had he was like this computer generated like head that would be like, ooh, oh my God. And he would like do this crazy shit on TV. Even I was a kid when this came out. But Max Headroom was a digital icon. Anyway, I mean, it's stupid to say, but he was like that. He was an avatar, basically. Max Headroom, you know? So, yeah, anyway, whatever.
I love wow. I love this headline from MIT's tech review website. There a woman, the metaverse. Oh, there it is.
that's him.
This is the head. Bedroom. The headline of this article is "The Metaverse Has a Groping Problem Already," and that's where we're gonna leave that topic. Anyway,
yeah,
Junior.
Yeah.
We do.
We'll get canceled. We'll get.
We will get. Canceled. We cannot be canceled in the metaverse before we've entered it. I don't want that to happen. Yeah. We do a bunch of segments on the show that are fun questions to prompt some stories. We'd love to throw you into one right now.
Go for it.
So this one is called Music Dropout. All right. So tomorrow you're like, fuck the metaverse. Fuck music. I'm out of all of it. And I'm going somewhere and I'm going to do something completely disconnected from what I've been doing. What is that thing when you drop out of music and the greater entertainment industry?
Is that even possible for someone that starts at like 11?
Yeah.
No, it totally is. I would just take me to the water. Take me to a beach, to a boat, and just let me be. Like, let me swim. Let me go out and get some sun. Eat a little bit of food. That's it. Like, I don't need just water, sun. I'm good.
Good
sand. That's all. That's like my dream. My dream. If I could escape. If I was like dumb, succession wealthy, I'll just live on a boat in the middle of the ocean for the rest of my life.
Mm-hmm. Wow, really?
At that point,
100%, without a doubt, and live off the grid and just literally just go from ocean to ocean, dock, enjoy whatever country I'm in, go back, go place to place, make music, satellite. That's it. Bye.
I have a good friend whose roommate did that like 4 years ago. He does like cybersecurity, and I guess he still works remote, but he just lives on a boat And he like showed up to my friend's wedding. He's like, yeah, I docked like over here, but I was living down. It's like, wow, that's a life, man.
That's a beautiful life.
I love it.
That's awesome.
No commitments.
Yeah, that's what I would do.
And while you were doing that, I assume you would go back to producing music, but it would just be for yourself.
For you.
I would always do it. I do a lot of things now that, you know, sustain me monetarily. Like, I have different businesses and different things, but I never stop making music. Like, I can't. I don't know how. I don't know how I could just stop. You know, it's like breathing for me. It's part of what I do. I do it when I'm happy. I do it when I'm sad. I do it when I'm stressed out. I do it when I'm angry. I do it like when I'm horny. Like, I just make music because that whatever emotion is through me, I need to do that. And it's weird. It's a weird thing. But, you know, when I first started doing this, there was no preconceived notion of success. It was only like, wow, I can do that. I can like create sounds and drums and synth. Like, I can, you know, it was like I fell in love with this house music and I just never could stop. It's weird.
Do you find like, cause I don't know, these days Nick and I both have kids and like, I just don't just sit down and fuck around.
I got three kids, man.
All right. So then this is a perfect question for you. Like, how often do you find like, you just get to sit down with like, I'm not trying to make this kind of track or I have to get this done, where you just sit down and you purely just do whatever you want and just experiment. Like, do you get to do that often?
I do that a lot. That's probably more than you think. So let's say if I had a pie and it's 100% of my life so far, I've probably done that about 89 to 90% of my life.
Damn.
God bless you. That's amazing.
That is amazing.
And that's probably why I'm not that much more successful. You know, like to be quite honest with you, because I have marched by the beat of my own drum. I've never remixed something I didn't like. I never worked with anyone I didn't want to. And it wasn't because I was snobby or because I was like, or because I was paid. It's just because I don't know. I had to learn how to put business first sometimes and not the art first.
Yeah.
Like I'm the weirdo. Like, in a way of like, art was to me the most important thing and money was second. I remember working with a band at the time, maybe in the mid 2000s, that were signed to DreamWorks when DreamWorks was still around as a label. And I had this tour in Australia that was a really significant, I mean, you know, over six figure tour, you know, way over six figures. And I just didn't go. The car service is in front of my house. Managers call me, is like, they're waiting for you. I'm not going. Why? Because I want to produce this band. And they're like in my house drinking from fucking funnels. They're Canadian and they're just like drunk. Was that a smart decision? Absolutely not. Did it help me grow? And in the process of that record, I recorded to tape. I had a 24 track 2-inch tape machine, Atari MTR-90, and I did it on there. And I did think, did it help me become a better producer? Yes. Did it financially hurt me? Yeah. Was it, what should I have gotten in that car and did my obligations and go and DJ like I was supposed to? Absolutely. But what, was I a stubborn, rebellious motherfucking kid? Yeah. You know?
Right. No, it is. That brings up an interesting point, because there's a lot of like artists who watch the show that are on the come up, trying to break through and trying to figure out like, is it worth spending money on school? Or if I lose money in a deal, like, is that worth it? And this, that, and the third. And like, yo, the amount of opportunities and gigs and deals where we've like just made a bad decision or whatever the fuck and lost probably a lot are up there. But what do you gain in growth from that, and what you won't do down the line when maybe it's a bigger opportunity?
Yeah.
And because you fumbled that early one, you know now with this one what to do. I remember, early on, we knew the guys at Splice. Like right before they launched, or like right after.
When it was still like the collaboration platform and not the sample stuff.
Yeah, yet. And like nobody was really talking about it a lot yet. But we probably could have invested and didn't at that time. I didn't fucking have my head wrapped around that enough. But now, like, there's plenty of companies that pop up and I'm like, that's good. But wouldn't have thought about any of that shit if I didn't fumble the bag on the fucking Splice thing.
Well, we grow up. It's age, man. We listen. Yeah. we're different than our parents because, like, our parents at our parents our age now. I don't know how old you guys are, but at your ages and my age, our parents they lived. There was a whole different like. Look at your parents at your age now; they were totally different.
Yeah.
We're at a different place where you're more young minded. Look at us. We have fucking. You have headphones on. It's colorful. You got a bad hat on. You have kids. Our parents weren't as cool as us. No. Like it's we're in a different generation, but we learn from our experiences. We're older. We're wiser. I didn't have the guidance like a lot of other people did in the field. Like when they're just like, you know, hey, you should make a left. No, turn right. Hey, you just made a dollar, but you know, take 75 cents and put it in this dividend. Like nobody said that shit to me.
Right.
I was like, I was a kid. I was like, oh shit, a new. You know, I made dumb decisions like buy a digital console when it first came out and pay like 10 grand and 2 years later sold it for $2,000. Like, you know, like dumb shit. Like don't invest in, you know, digital technology like that in a studio because it's not going to be worth much later. You know, I had to learn all that stuff early on, young. But then, you know, I bought a 33102 Neve for about $7,000 in like 1997 and sold it for like almost $25,000 in, you know, a couple years ago.
Wow.
Like, yeah, you know, like, you know, it's, I mean, it's a long time, but it's, you know, it is a nice return, you know, but so it's all, you know, we learn as we grow, man. Like we're just kids and diving into a world that it's completely unfamiliar. Like I didn't grow up with, you know, people in, you know, I'm the youngest of six, but none of my brothers were business savvy. I mean, successful now, but they didn't grow up in the stock market. They didn't want to like do that. I didn't grow up in that, like in that environment. I grew up in the hood. You know, I'm Brazilian and Italian, grew up in Newark, New Jersey. And my mom moved to the suburbs at like I was 13 and I felt way out of place, you know? So, you know, I say my university was, music was my saving grace. My university was the world. I got on a plane, it's right when I graduated high school and I never looked back. And my growth was, you know, I spent most of my time in London and in Ibiza, and that was how I learned how to live and how to, my, you know, learning from being on the road, man, and making music. Music was my educator, you know.
I love that.
Yeah,
love that. All right, I'm gonna throw you into another one of these segments. This one is called Nightmare Story. All right.
I love these little. All
right. So this is you can reserve names. It could be studio driven, tour driven, or just greater entertainment industry topics. But feel free to tell your music nightmare story.
Oh man, music nightmares. I've had a few. I've had good ones. Like where I felt like I was a hero and I felt like once I was the villain, I had to learn. When I was younger, like super young, and I first started getting into remixing and on major labels, I remixed something for someone and it got rejected from a major label. And I remember being at this festival and then the A&R guy was there and I pinned him to like the wall. And I was like, you don't like my remix?
Yeah, that's a move.
Yeah, man.
So on some like Suge Knight shit, but whatever. I was just a kid. Like, and then somebody pulled me to the side, like, yo, Junior, you cannot be aggressive to the A&Rs or choke them because they don't like your remix. Like, that's just not what you do. I'm like, oh, so I learned that. But then, you know, fast forward years later, I was working with a band in another country, and the person that worked for their publishing company was like, yo, we love this song in particular. And it was like her, she was on, this person, the singer was on, she was a recovering addict. She was on heroin. Mm. So I listened to the cassette and it was her mumbling, like just mumbling, blah, 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 blah. But the melody was fucking beautiful. It was about, maybe it was, actually it was, she was, it was like a minute long Spotify time. And, we made a song out of it. Got her in the studio. I remember, like, she had a boyfriend that was the bass player, and I had to find him. He was like, I'm not even joking, not a reference to Red Hot Chili Peppers. He was under a bridge near the studio shooting up. I had to find him.
Jesus.
Get him in the studio, get them to record. long story short, we did this great record. Beautiful, man. Beautiful record with so much meaning, so much heart that the publisher listened to it. I remember we got done. The label loved it. Everyone loved it. Except for the guy that played me the cassette. He was like, man, she doesn't sound like she's hurting. I need her to hurt. She needs to be in pain. And I'm like, you motherfucker, you made her go to recovery. I'm like, you guys did intervention. She's clean. We made this beautiful record out of something that was nothing. What did you want me to do? Run into the studio, stab her in the neck with heroin for you? So you can get your emotion out of it? Like, everyone loves it. This is a beautiful record. So that pissed me off. That made me, you know, kind of lose faith in the process and these record executives wanting what they wanted. And it doesn't matter what you do to get
right,
it.
Right.
And I went and I fought with him for her. Like, I fought with the president of the publishing company for her and went out and punched the elevator wall, and it was made out of marble, and I fractured my hand. And but I did that to me because I cared about her so much and her artistry and what she went through and what we created, and I believed in it. So yeah, that was a nightmare story, just, you know, like being in front of a president of a publishing company and him being an asshole.
Yeah, that's terrible, man. Like, the fact that it'll always exist, right? Like, that hierarchy structure where people just give an opinion because they have the power to give an opinion, but there's really no value in it. It's really frustrating for, I think, new artists especially. Like, we're of the school of thought now where we're like, we just give a fuck. Like, if you don't like the record, go fuck yourself. I don't really care otherwise. Like, it doesn't matter to me.
Of course, some deals
I'd love to have other than...
But it's different now when you have so many options versus back in the day.
Like, back then, like, being young, being passionate.
Right.
Your art is everything. Like, everything. There's nothing else. Like, there is no... like, nothing else exists but, you know, you putting your heart and soul into something, man. And I had to learn, like, you know, sometimes you got to just let it be. Like, his fight wasn't really with me. It was with her, even though I produced the record. But it's not my fault. That's his problem. I should have just, like, okay, whatever. The label likes it. That's your problem.
Yeah.
And right. Left.
Yeah, yeah.
But meanwhile, she's hope. I'm sticking up for her. I'm fighting her fight.
Right.
And I shouldn't have been. So, I mean, it's, you know, you're young and you just have this passion. Like, I was a very, very passionate person when it came to music because that's what I believed in. That's, you know, that was like, that's all I had in my life. Yep. Like, you know, you take that shit away, I couldn't breathe.
You know? Are you working with a lot of, like, up and coming artists at the moment or kind of mentoring or managing anybody?
Yeah, no, well, not managing. No, I never do that. So I just recently did, I executive produced and co-produced a lot of stuff for Cookie Kawai's album. I don't know if you know Cookie Kawai. She's an artist that's from New Jersey. She had a really huge record on TikTok that was called Back It Up. It was like big ass record. And she's on Empire. And it so happens that we connected during the pandemic. And then she's signed to Benji and Joel's management company, Good Charlotte. And then we hooked up, and it's a lot of club music. It's like, you know, Jersey Club, Baltimore Club. And I helped her with that. So beyond that, I'm going to continue to work with her later on. Like, we built a great rapport, but not really mentoring a lot of young artists. I'm getting back. I was kind of, I worked with Azalea Banks.
Spawn in the chat said, you've got kids. You don't need to manage an artist.
What's up, Spawn? I like that. Spawn. DJ Spawn. Matt, that's true. I don't. I got a 10-month-old. That shit is crazy. When I worked with Azalea, that was an experience that kind of after that I produced on a wind tour, the track on a wind tour. And I was kind of like, you know, let me chill with the artist stuff. Cause it was an experience that was cool. I just wanted to concentrate more on what I was doing and diving back in and making singles. And cause it takes a lot out of you when you produce for others or working with them. And when I work with somebody, especially on a project or, like, I really put my all into it. Like, for example, see, I just forgot. I just produced, it just came out this year. So you guys watch Bob's Burgers? Mm-hmm. Or no? Mm-hmm. You know the show?
Yeah.
So the voice of Linda, his name is John Roberts. And I did his album. And I got Tommy to remix and a bunch of other remixers. But I produced his album. It's very new wave, very Duran Duran-ish type of stuff. And, yeah, I did that. You know, I did that too because I heard his voice. He loved what I did, and we sat down, and I heard a lot of what he was writing and his voice. I was like, he's actually really, really, really good. And I just did his album, and that was an 8-month process.
Yeah.
You know, and I went in and sat with him in a studio in Brooklyn, and a lot of it was done in my house. And it was just, I really do like to give my attention to, and it takes a lot out of you, depending on who you're working with.
Right.
Yes. So it's hard to do the artist thing, like put your singles out when you've got your head in someone else's project.
Well, I learned to partition my brain now more than before. Before I would like literally have to give you my all. Now I can work on something, stop, and then make a track for Snatch or something, and then come back and, you know, make a record that has nothing to do with underground house music. Like I learned as I got older to kind of like, you know, partition my brains and segments and easily go from, you know, just, you know, drive one to drive two. And but before I couldn't, I didn't know how to do that.
And it's probably, I know for us, it's like, it's creatively refreshing to be able to do that, because you give drive one a break. Drive one needs a break sometimes to get away and refresh and whatever. So
yeah, I was thinking about this the other day. I'm always doing something, but I have spurts that I'm just really productive and prolific. Yep. And I haven't been in the past few weeks. I come in, I'm like dilly dallying, but I've done so much stuff that I don't need to do a lot, but it's getting to the point where I'm like, damn, I want to create. Meanwhile, I have records that are yet to come out, that are scheduled to come out, that are in drive, still demos, but I'm constantly feeling like I'm behind. Mm-hmm. I'm constantly feeling like I think
that's a common feeling. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it is weird because I think a lot of people do that. I know we do, where you'll be super inspired and you'll crank out like 6 things, and then that lasts you half a year, and you might go through like another 3-month dry spell before you get like creatively inspired again. But then inevitably, somehow it hits again, and you get another batch of stuff. How do you deal with like those spots, like where you are sort of like stuck creatively and just nothing's coming?
It's funny because I was going to bring that specific topic up right now. Is usually you listen to other music, right? But that doesn't necessarily work too much now because everything sounds the same. Like it's hard to find inspiration. So I watch films, read books, cook, get out, you know, hang out with friends and talk about different things. Sometimes watching a movie will spark something that will lead me to do something, a word, a phrase, like, oh shit, he said, da, 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 and I want to like create around that, whatever that phrase is. But usually I would listen to other inspirational artists. Now I'm like going backwards and listening to like, you know, Kid A or the Cardigans, you know, one of the second album that is fucking, to me, is one of the best mixed albums ever. Or like, I'm just going back and I in the car yesterday, my daughter was in the car. We watched Spider-Man yesterday, which is awesome, by the way.
No spoilers, please.
No, I'm not saying anything, but it was fantastic. I was a little annoyed at certain things, but it was amazing. So I'm in a car and I'm driving. I'm listening to Timeless. I'm listening to Goldie. And she's like, Dad, what is this? And my daughter's pretty, she's got a great palette for music. And then it's long. I mean, Timeless is like, the intro is like 8 minutes before their first fucking drum comes in, you know? And the drum came in, and I'm fucking going crazy in the car. I got a boyfriend in the back seat. My son is in the middle seat. I'm driving to watch the Spider-Man. I'm bugging out. She's looking at me like, what the fuck are you playing? I'm like, and she's 16. I'm like, this is what I was listening to, Chloe, when I was 16. And even though I loved what I, you know, house music, I would go to AWOL in London or, you know, the drum and bass parties in New York. And this is what, and I'm like, watch, pop records are going to be made out of this right now. She looked at me, she goes, okay, I get it. I can see it. But that's, you know, finding inspiration in the past too, sometimes helps the future.
Cause she's totally like, yeah, cool, Dad. That's great.
Well, give it like a year and someone's going to flip it. And then
you'll be proven right. John Parker in the chat, our good buddy, is asking, is going back and listening to amazing house artists of the 80s, does that help with inspiration?
Oh, yeah, always. What's up, John Parker? 100%, always. Like, for example, Little Louis. He's the perfect, to me, the blueprint of what people like myself and Armand built our careers off of. Because not only did he do Club Lonely, but he did Video Clash. you know, Blackout, aggressive records, techno records, but beautiful house records. Like Club Loney is a beautiful vocal. I mean, if you love me, take me higher and higher. Like, that's a beautiful. And then he could just like Blackout at the flick of God switch. French Kiss. Like, that diversity is our blueprint. That's why we made records. That's why Armand would make flowers to Witch Doctor. That's why we wanted to make records that were broad and had a palette, because we were inspired by producers like Little Lewis, or to me, like Trevor Horn. He went from producing to Guess Who, to Seal, to Tattoo, to ABC, you know, Art of Noise. How much more versatility? That's amazing. So to me, in dance music, it's about being versatile. And how, if house music is a tree and you have branches, like, you have techno, which is obviously black music from Detroit, no matter what anybody wants to believe, that's what it is. House music is from the United States of America. New York has its blueprint. Chicago has its blueprint. We can fight about who did what, but those are the two main motherfuckers. And Miami had a stint in Miami Bass and freestyle, and so did New York. So we have, it's our shit. I can honestly say the UK, y'all motherfuckers invented drum and bass, without a fucking doubt. Trance is y'all, you guys, you brought it over to us. We don't own that shit. But house music and techno music is us. That's why Demure and I started this label Culture to really paint, to keep the narrative, without diluting it. Like, because that's what happened. People want to like dilute it and change it as the years go by. Oh, people don't remember this. So let's say this. Let's say that David Guetta was a godfather of house music. No, that's not true. So. So to answer your question, homie, do listening to 80s records inspire, or 80s house or producers from that time? 100%. And I would suggest you listening to Little Lewis in the World, Journey for the Lonely. His first two albums are great. You want to listen to an amazing house record? Frankie Knuckles. I mean, shit.
Something tells me Mr. Parker's up on all of it.
Yes.
He knows his shit. I am curious, like, because you've DJed for a lot of bigger artists, too, just, like, doing stuff, even with Madonna, like, remixing a lot of major label artists and whatnot, but your sound and, like, the perception of your brand has always been, like, firmly rooted in house music, even if you went off and did rock stuff, or you did, like, really commercial stuff, or you did commercial gigs. I feel like the brand was still, like, firmly rooted in house.
Yeah. It was hard to navigate in the between. Like, you know, I would go to London and play Trash, Errol's Night, and I got to do a lot of things. I think my Roxton, a lot of people don't know. So house music, it was very, the information's out there, but it's pre-social media. So it's almost like they don't know that I went off and did this and that, and that, and that. Or, you know, I had a stint working with Block Party or remixing The Bravery and all these things that I did. Which is fine, which is all good. I mean, it's there. If somebody researches, it's there. No matter what I did, at the core, I had my dance music, house music blueprint. That's just what, there's a taste. There's a level of taste, man. And that's what it is. But when I worked with bands or artists, depending on who they were, I never tried to make them me. I just tried to enhance who they were, adding a little bit of what I come from, if needed. If not, no. Like, even when remixing, there was times I turned down remixes because I felt like I couldn't add to this in any way. Like, I couldn't remix it. I just liked the original song too much. I'm like, I'm just going to fuck this up. I don't know what I'm going to do because I think this is just too good. And whatever I did, even though it's a different style, I just can't wrap my head around what I would do because I don't know. I can't add value to it. So, remixing is a fun way to express yourself.
It is, you know, it's interesting because we talked about like hip hop and dance music kind of crossing paths, and it's interesting because like I got into dance music really through rock music that had dance music in it. So, Air, The Killers, Hot Hot Heat. I don't know, bands of that time.
I remix Hot Hot Heat. Let me in.
Get the fuck out of here. That's so interesting. So, but it's like that had to be such an interesting time where there wasn't a lot of overlap. And I know Tommy was heavily involved in a lot of that, like whether it was Scissor Sisters, or I know there were a bunch that he was involved
with. I booked Scissor Sisters to play my first. I had a night at I had a band called Output, and then we had a night at Central Fly that my band played. Scissor Sisters opened for us. We paid them $300.
Oh shit!
I remember that. amazing time. Me and Tommy got a lot of history like that. Tommy knows me very well when it comes to like the stint that we're talking about here, working with this band or remixing Hot Hot Heat or The Killers, for example. Or I had a band with Russell from Block Party, which people won't know. He knows that. Like Tommy was around a lot during that time. Tommy faxed the lyrics for Silver Screen to my basement. So that's how we record that record.
Facts.
That's amazing. Well, and then it's interesting because then that all happened kind of right before the EDM thing took off. I mean, that was like...
Oh, yeah. Way before.
But I mean, like 5 years or something. In my mind, it feels like it wasn't that far removed.
No. Yeah. So I'm talking... When you were talking about Tommy and, like, let's say Silver Screen, that was... Wait, hold on, let's see.
What was that, 2001 or something?
Yeah, so an EDM didn't happen
2008, 2009.
When Love Takes Over. Yeah, so you're talking about 10 years, man.
Yeah, no, that's true.
Where do you see things kind of going? Like, do you feel like you need to push, I don't know, do you feel a responsibility to push the sound of house music forward in any way? Or do you think doing, like, the classic house now is what the scene requires?
Man, you know what's funny, you said about your brand. I've never ever thought about myself as a brand, and that's another reason why I probably not as successful I should be, because I just never had that mindset. I should have. But I love being diverse and just having, you know, that classic palette of house. Like, to me, house again can be piano driven or it can be synth driven. It could be, you know, techno is soulful, man. Like when you ask Carl Craig and sit down with him, like, yo, what's techno? I mean, those are as housey as house records. I mean, listen to Good Life, Inner City. That's a techno record, but a house record. So it's just about, you know, whatever you can't spell art without heart. And so whatever you put your heart into and there's soul in it, to me, it could ride between house and techno and aggressive and not and cool, as long as you get you put your soul into that shit, man. And that's what I love, and I'll continue to do that forever. Like, some records today I might wake up and make something a little bit more aggressive, like Preacher Man, but it says something that's meaningful and soulful. Or it could be the record I just did with Shermanology that has pianos in it, like, you know, I don't know. But it's just like,
shout out to those guys, because I've been watching what they're doing. And number one, the records they're doing are amazing. And the fact that they are, like, running their own ship now and got their own label and publishing deal. And I love that they have, like, a new sense of purpose in the industry.
Andy and Dorothy are great. It's funny because I saw them. I didn't realize this, but Andy reminded me. He was like, Junior, you were the first one. We decided to come back. They just embraced us. I'm like, of course. I mean, why wouldn't I embrace you guys? That's what this culture is about. Embracing community,
right?
Opportunity, helping each other. That's what house music is. Like, that's why we did the Mongoloids, the Wu-Tang of house. We wanted to be a collective of people that either we work together, remix each other, you know, DJ to get whatever it is. We wanted to be a community that gave, you know, that helped each other. And that's what, you know, that's what the problem is a lot today. It's just like, it's more ego driven and I'm this DJ, I make this, and I, you know, look at me. And instead of actually, like, there's enough for everybody, let's all help each other. You know, if you fuck with, if you genuinely like a person, why not help them and be happy for their success?
I mean, it's the dopest part of, like, this show and, like, the links we get in here and a lot of the up and coming artists that we support on the label is, like, when they go off and do some big shit, it's fucking killer. Like, if anything, it's a big win for us too, because it reflects back on us looking like, oh, these guys actually do have good taste in music and they gave a shit.
Yeah, you know, and I think there's room for everybody. Like, you know, there's artists that I'm friends with that musically they're not my cup of tea, but I don't judge them by the music they make.
Sure.
That's not why we're friends. I actually like them as a human being. You know, just because I don't like your sneakers doesn't mean I can't hang with you. So, you know, I differentiate that shit. It's not, to me, it's not about, you know, yeah, I mean, I wouldn't go to listen to Steve play Aoki, but is he a friend? Yeah. Do I know him even before his success, even before what he's doing today with the cakes? Absolutely. Do I, as a person, do I like him? 100%. Do I agree with everything he does? No, but that's okay.
That's like, humanity. You know, that's, you're right.
That's humanity, man. Like, it's all good. But some people don't, you know, they can't, you know, they, it's like we're in this like clicky thing where like, you,
yeah, they want to paint it black or white. Like, you have to agree with everything or like condemn.
Yeah, I don't got shit to prove to anybody. I've been cool since kindergarten and I don't give a fuck.
I love that.
Yeah, anybody, that's the clip right there.
It doesn't matter to me. Like, it's all good.
Yeah, man.
I love it. I, speaking of Dimmock and Steve, after the show, there is a show we roll into called Dope or Nope. So that'll be at 3 p.m. Eastern, you guys who are watching. Dope or Nope, it's basically like we listen to demos every week, and there's a panel of people. It's me, George Hess, Lauren Padman.
Oh, George.
Yeah, the best, man. And Lauren.
I want to be a guest on that show.
Yeah.
Oh, you totally should be. Yeah.
You should be. So a conversation I got into with Lauren from Dimmock last week was he played a record. I think it was the new record from Sam Felt with Rita Ora. Okay. Yeah, anyway, yeah. It's like piano, dance, pop, whatever. And I love the record. It's really good. Production isn't crazy, but like the vocal's killer and the track supports the vocal. So anyway, his feedback was, well, this doesn't do anything for music. Like it doesn't move the sound forward. And I said, well, who gives a fuck? Because it's a good song. It's catchy and like it just functions in the space as a good song. Like what does it have a responsibility to, I'm curious about your take on this.
Everything needs to push it forward. Yeah. Right.
No, not everything needs to push boundaries and push it forward. That would make music ridiculous. Like we have to have a balance. Like there has to be a balance of yin and yang and good and bad. Like it can't be one way. When there's an off balance, that's when I'm like, oh shit, there's way too much whack shit out that's dominated, that's taking up market shit.
Yeah,
you know, and when it's harder to find the good shit, there's a problem, you know. And I think technology has kind of exponentially like gave everyone a lot of fucking, you know, back in the day you'll have the Macarena or MC Hammer or Vanilla Ice. Like you had these moments of like, I don't fuck with this, you know? Like, right. You gotta be honest. Like, who liked the Macarena?
Right.
Biggest record in the world, but it was, did it push the culture forward? No, it created it. It was like the first TikTok dance, you know? Okay. And in theory, right? But I don't agree with that statement because I don't think every record needs to push the button. There's great records, man. They're just great records. Doesn't necessarily change pop music, doesn't change whatever genre they're in. It's just a good fucking record. Like, there's, you know, damn, man. Drake doesn't really, as of recent, push any cultural buttons, but his records are good. Like,
right, they serve a purpose. Yeah, yeah.
They serve a purpose. You know, a lot of times I'm like, okay, you know, if I'm driving and I don't shut it off, okay, I can hear it. But there's records that he does. It's like, well, girls, girls. And I'm like, who? What the fuck is this?
Right. Right. As long as there's a healthy balance between records that are just there to be there, and then ones that push the envelope. As long as that balance stays, then you're good.
But that's the problem. It's like, do we have that balance? Like, you know, I can say this, and I will love. I'll ask you guys this question: who's our Sade? Who's our Radiohead? Who's our Depeche Mode? Who's our Prince today?
Yeah.
That's the problem. The problem is we don't really have, I mean, we can argue and say Billie Eilish serves a purpose of that.
Right, Adele, yeah, yeah, Adele.
Or we can have a healthy conversation, but when you really break it down, there's artists that transcend the algorithm and transcend the metrics. That's what I'm looking for always. Mm-hmm. Radiohead doesn't need, Sade doesn't need, Bjork doesn't need, they don't need this world that now is going on.
Right.
They can transcend this shit. Adele doesn't need it.
Right.
She doesn't need fucking Instagram.
No, I mean, so, Adele said that's why she doesn't do TikTok. She was like, I don't fucking need TikTok. Like, everybody's going to... She wasn't even, like, flexing. She was just like, everybody's going to pay attention when I put out an album, so I'm focused on the album. That's it.
Yeah.
No, but she also said this. She was like, yo, I don't make records for that demographic. My life experience is... Well, my life experience. And if I'm concentrating to make records for a certain age group, like, say, TikTok, who's making records for my age group?
Right.
Yeah. Who's making records for people that are going through the same struggles that I have, or gone through a divorce, or did this, or lost weight, or whatever the fuck it is? Art is about who you're connecting with. If you're trying to connect, like, if you're Madonna right now and trying to connect to a fucking 12-year-old, you lost the fucking
thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, you're just gone. Because right. That's not what it's about. You know, you have to kind of resonate with the frequency that you can. You can't, if you're forcing a frequency, you're just going to fuck it up. You just, right. You lost yeah. it, you know? If, you know, so if I'm turning around right now and I'm trying to make, now, what the fuck am I going to do that shit for?
Right, right,
right.
That's the most uncomfortable feeling. What I just did just fucked me up. It's the most uncomfortable frequency for me to try to force yeah. music that has nothing to fucking do with me.
Mm-hmm. Right.
No, I don't connect with that. The kids that like that, they still have a journey to get to where I'm at. And sure. I'm already different because I'm older. So they have their life journey and they'll get there. They'll discover, their palates will change. They might, you know, it's like no different than a kid that's growing up. It's like, I don't like broccoli. Next, you know, it's just a palate. They have to grow. But imagine me right now talking all this shit and I get off this and I make a record and it sounds like that. You motherfuckers are like, what is Junior Sanchez doing?
No, I'd be like, somebody dangled the bag in front of him and he was getting that, you know, cash.
That's real shit. And yeah. I respect Adele for that because she's like, man, I'm just making records that are true to me and I want, and I'm making records that people can relate to me. And that's, you can't get realer than that. Yeah.
Agreed. From a production standpoint and from like an artist perspective, what are the biggest missteps you see like with new artists right now that they're making?
Sample packs, you know, like taking stuff and just mimicking, a lot of mimicking, you know, now every record is R&B vocal with a certain beat and, you know, and everyone's like, okay, I got to mimic that, like that A Craze record or whatever. And
yeah.
I get it, but it's like, that's the problem. The problem is kids not having, I believe in like, we all have fingerprints, and I believe as artists, we have our own sound. And if you can figure out what your sound print is, you're going to truly, you know, excel in your craft and become a better artist. Because if you're constantly mimicking somebody else, you know, but that's the thing. A lot of, you know, I would say there's a lot of artists, you guys made a good point. It's more accessible. It's easier. Technology made it easier. So the abundance of music creators are, you know, ridiculous. So there's going to be a lot that are not into this for the reasons that you got into it or I got into it.
Right.
They're just doing it because it's no different than being, you know, being fashionable, being, you know, being going and buying a high, you know, the certain pair of sneakers or Supreme. Like, I'm a Supreme head. Right. And then they grow out of that. They're not. Now I'm rock. Or they just go through phases. But that's the problem. I think that's the issue today. It's mimicking. Everybody's trying to duplicate what's happening. Everybody's trying to get on, you know, Diplo's Revolution.
Yeah, I think we might have talked about this with a previous guest about how, like, the fact that there are sample packs and there's like preset packs, it makes it very easy to sound a certain way very quickly. But you never have to learn. You're never learning how to do anything, which makes it very difficult to develop your own sound because you're not learning anything. You're just being handed the tools and you get to work. And I mean, I imagine like you came there, like you said, you would have like the Roland instruction manual written in Japanese and translated into English. And that's pretty much all you had to go off of, except for talking to buddies.
God, I just had dinner with Armand Van Helden at Basel. We were at a Carbones and we're sitting down, we're talking, and we were talking about how we used to work, I had like two or three S3000s. That was like when I started really, you know, making some money off records. And, you know, I was like, oh shit, buying a sampler. That's expensive shit.
Yeah, man.
And I remember how we used to create beats was we used to take a day or a few days and listen to some shit or make a track. As I'm making the track, I'm like, pick up a record. Oh, kick. Sample kick. Hat. Snare. Load up the sampler. Have the keyboard. Spread it out. Start making the track. Never saving. And once I'm done with the track, boom, shut off the sampler. Start again. Start again. Start again. We never thought. We were like, yo, why we never saved our fucking sounds? We just constantly... starting, you know how crazy that conceptually that is? That's fucking nuts.
Yeah. Well, and then to have like a consistent sound because you're like, you're always looking for new samples, but you have an ear for certain things. So you're always finding like.
Yeah, you're right. So on that point, Armand, we forgot, like Todd would do the same thing. Like Todd is one of my, best friends. And he would be like, yo, the reason why his records would sound a certain way for a certain time, like a span of releases, let's say, is because they recycle the same drums. And then they were like tired of it. Like, okay, we use this enough, shut it off. New sounds, new drums, you know, it's like, they had, you know, that's what Armand did. There was a stint. I remember Armand was like, he had all these remixes that sounded drums wise sounded similar. It's because you just use the same drums all the time. And it was a faster way of working. He was like, all right, new remix, like, you know, get everything out of there and just, you know, use the same drums. It's very interesting. But it was a lot of work. It was a lot of work to constantly sample all the time. My first workstation was a Roland W30. Had two banks of 7.4 second each bank. That's it. So maybe 16 seconds, and you had to make a track out of that. Sample in 45 just to speed up, truncate, and then play it lower on the octave so you can get the sample. Like, that was how we worked.
That's wild.
That is insane. Yeah. All right, I'm going to throw you into another segment here. This one is called What Would You Do?
And now we answer the question, what would you do?
All right, so here's the premise. The premise is tomorrow you wake up, you've got all the same skills and knowledge you have today, but you don't know anybody on the new earth that exists tomorrow. So you don't necessarily have a career in music, but you know how to produce music. You have no contacts in the music industry because it's all new humans, but you know how to navigate the music industry. So with all of that premise set up, and with the idea that there's many new artists in this stage of
skills, they have experience, but they have no connection into the industry yet.
Yeah, or know-how with anything. Yeah. What are the first steps you take in 2022 now to make a career in the music business?
So my question is that new world just like this world, meaning it's technology is the same, everything's the same?
Yeah.
So I'm just born into a new, like a multiverse thing, like a different...
Yeah, pretty much.
Right.
So another dimension where it's just completely refreshed and new, but it's exactly the same.
Yeah.
Yep. No contacts though. So you got to start from scratch with contacts and like,
you can't call up your boy and start from there.
Yeah.
I would open up a restaurant or some shit. I do not have any fucking idea how you can amass any amount of, it's wow. That's deep.
So if you had to pick one way, like if you were like, I think you should push into Web3 and NFTs, or I think you should.
That's probably
like...
the best question I have ever had in my life.
Woo! We made it.
I think I don't know. I mean, yeah, maybe an NFT thing, like knowing, but if the world, I don't.
We stumped him, folks.
Yeah, it's like some people are like
crazy.
Some people say they would get at it the same way they got in, like just start going out to clubs and meeting people. Or I mean, but it's like that's true.
No, like what club? You know what I would do? I would start up the first club in the metaverse. Fuck it, open up a club, like Ministry of Sound, but in the metaverse, make that shit pop in. Everybody comes to me. I'm the first real venue. Live venue in the metaverse, live bands and clubs. So I would open up a live band venue, club venue, a whole entertainment sector in the metaverse where you got to come to me in that world.
I love that you had no idea how to answer the question. You already got a conglomerate with a mass facility built.
You inspired it. You inspired it. See, that's why I got to give you guys a percentage.
We'll take we'll take a slice.
Offline, you know, yeah. We'll make it happen.
I love
it. We'll do another version of Finish My Track in the metaverse in there too.
I love it. It's awesome. Well, so what do you, before we let you go for the day, what do you got coming up? Yeah. What are people looking forward to?
What are you excited about next year?
I have an album that I finished during quarantine with Dallas Austin. He executive produced a record. It's titled Soundprint Embryo. It's like from what I consider to, you know, it's a reflection of house music from my beginning, you know, to now. And it spans an array of genres, but all house, all dance music, whether it be mid-tempo, up-tempo, but even to like Mantronic stuff. There's a lot of great guests on the record. Even Mike Dean, I get a collaboration with Mike Dean on there, and it's really cool.
Awesome.
I really would like to see the light of day. I want to do something where there's a visual component to the album where you can walk and you can listen to a song, and that's the song is more 1983 Bronx, the Fever freestyle type Mantronic stuff. So if you walk into a room, it takes you there. Maybe you're in the Fever, you're in the Bronx, and you're experiencing that audibly but visually as well. And then you go to another room and see another song, and that takes you to like the subway because it's Chicago, or you know, or, you
dope.
Know what I'm saying? Like, so
yeah.
That's kind of what I'm putting together for that. And then a lot of new singles, a lot of new records coming out, and you know, working with some artists like Cookie, and just, you know, being consistent and trying to just do what I do. More stuff on culture tours coming out with myself and Demure. And Robot is, you know, very prolific with music, and we still continue to release records and put out some amazing stuff. And that's it, man. You know, stay cemented in what I do and put out great ass house music and underground music, and just, you know, continue to be me without trying to like force anything.
I love it. You
know? I love it, man. Yeah.
Yo, thank you so much for just being an inspiration in the business and in dance music and all you contributed to the scene and everything, man. It's super inspiring for us.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. You guys are kicking ass. Keep killing it, man. Keep doing what you guys are doing. You know, and it's crazy because as hard as we work, we're like, damn, like how much harder do we have to work? Just do it, right? Just don't even think about it as hard work. I mean, I see you guys, you know, how do I put it this way? Like, these streams today, they count for something, but really, man, you win just by doing it. Like,
yeah,
you
no,
finish
for sure.
Your record, it's done. That's it. You put it out to the world, whether it gets accepted or not.
Exactly. That's the way you got over it.
You created it.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
It's dope. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Junior Sanchez.
Thank you, man.
We'll talk soon, man.
Yo, we'll break some bread soon.
Yes.
Are you guys in New York?
I'm in Jersey.
Where? Oh, are you? Tell me offline.
No. I'm down in like a Red Bank area.
Oh, dude, I'm in Central Jersey. I'm like in around Edison area.
Oh shit. Cool. Yo, we got to do a Tejas visit.
Need to.
Where you at?
I'm down in Virginia. I used to be up in New York and Jersey, but I'm down in Virginia now.
Oh, cool. All right.
Yeah, man.
We're hanging, Nick.
Yes. It's on me. Let's see you soon, bro.
All right, man. We'll exchange numbers. Peace.
Yep.
All right. Peace.
That's awesome. Nice. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for hanging out. We're not over yet. We're not over. I just felt the need to give him one more explosion. Yo, I could have talked about like the history of what he's done forever, just because I feel like he's been in the room with so many people that...
Yeah, no, it is. Like, the more I looked up stuff on him, because like I had a limited knowledge, like I knew his name from certain things, but like didn't know the depth of it. And like all the rock stuff, and like I was saying to you, like we kind of crossed paths in that like early EDM, but there was like another thing going on, like where he was with Steve Aoki and Laidback Luke, and Armand had just started Duck Sauce, and we were we were real into that kind of scene. So yeah, he's just an interesting dude, but it's cool that all of it comes from him just doing what inspires him creatively, and then somehow the business works out, which I mean, feel like is a lot of those the guys, ideal way to do it.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of those guys did it that way. Todd Terry, Tommy, like the like house guys that are known for being pioneers in that scene. It's pretty amazing because I definitely look at it a lot differently, but that's inspiring. And yeah, I think that's really tricky for a new artist now to do.
Yeah.
It's doable, but it's hard. Mm-hmm. It's harder.
Well, because you have to like, you have to do like a certain amount to make it financially, whatever, so that you don't have to worry about that,
right.
The business side of it. You're not like living like gig to gig or remix to remix.
Right.
So once you hit that, then it allows you the opportunity
right.
to open up. But yeah, it is like you have to get to that threshold, which is the tricky part.
Right. And then the other thing is like, I don't like preaching to just be picky and like think about just your art, because I feel like people have to go through shit. You got to take on some projects you don't necessarily give a fuck about and figure out a way to make it into something you give a fuck about.
I mean, it can't be something that you're like completely detached
right. from,
but I know what you mean. Just because you aren't like the most excited about a project doesn't mean you can't figure out a way to like get paid and have it be like consistent with your like art.
Shanahan said it's part of the process. Yo, and then the other thing is like maybe the record isn't the greatest thing in the world, but you know that via that record, you're going to have an angle to get in somewhere else. Maybe it's for a label that you want to put out on an original with, and like that's your means in.
Yeah.
You got to think about like three steps ahead, five steps ahead of.
Well, and I think that probably happens with like a lot of people, but it is interesting when certain people come up, like we meet someone that we've known, like we've looked up to for a long time, and they're like, oh shit, I remember this remix that you did yeah. in 2012. And I'm like, that's what you fucking know us for?
Yeah.
But it's like, you never know. It may not make a huge splash on one of the streaming platforms or social media or whatever. But like, you never know who's seen it. And that may be the thing that like down the line turns into the little like spark that continues your
yeah, fact. Your journey. By the way, I was on a deep dive the other night just looking up remixes and stuff because somebody yeah. brought up our Like a G6 remix to me, speaking of remixes yeah. uh-huh. from back in the day. And that one, which I forgot, ended up becoming an official after it was a bootleg.
Right.
It went from bootleg to re-identified as a remix. That one, there's a Katy Perry one. All these like went multi-platinum. Not, that's not a flex. That's just to tell you that we're... do some plaques.
Oh.
That's it.
Yeah, 8 days till Christmas. I'm just waiting under the tree. I remember that Far East Movement album. That was like one of the last physical like CDs that I bought. And it's because they like threw our names in the liner notes somewhere.
Oh, shit. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
Oh, today Hess is asking me for a link. Hold on. He's a StreamYard. You want to run through some of this music news and I guess we could talk about some of the stuff we're doing with Record Shop. We can't talk about certain things.
There's still details that are not announced. This I think we can talk about the cocktail party on Wednesday.
For sure we can.
I'm looking forward to. So I'm supposed to talk to you about it. So why don't we just talk about it on air?
Let's do it.
How long we think this is going to be? Like an hour?
Hour and a half.
2 hours? Hour and a half.
Depends how much bourbon you have to be drank.
I took it easy this year, so I have quite a bit still sitting around. That's one of the beautiful things about spirits is they never go bad.
Dude, like, I thought about this the other night. It's so weird you brought this up because I wanted an old fashioned the other day, right?
Yeah.
And I had, I don't know, maybe 2 years ago, poured bourbon into a carafe thing that you pour on top. One of those like old school ones. It's from like the 50s. It's really nice, but it's been sitting in there for like 2 years. It was perfect.
Exactly.
Would have never known.
Can't do that with like fucking milk or anything else.
Of all things.
You're like, oh, I want a white Russian. Oh, everything's good for except the cream.
Lisa had mentioned that it would have been a good idea for us to do cocktail packages. We missed that opportunity.
Yeah, we did. But I mean, there's still time to come up with some signature cocktails. We haven't announced, did we say prizes? I think we can say there'll be prizes. We just can't say what the prizes are.
Yeah, we'll figure some of that stuff out this week. But yeah. Some giveaways. This will be, by the way, if you guys are just jumping in, that is the RSVP link.
Yes.
For December 22nd, Wednesday, 8 p.m. Eastern. We'll bring on some guests. I know Lena Leon's going to come on.
Nice.
Boogie Hill Faders are doing something with the giveaway thing. So we got to plug them. Right. We need a cocktail.
Yeah, I think that's our homework for the weekend. You and I just have to hammer out like some cocktail, some recipes.
Yeah, until I'm hammered. That's what Shanahan said is our timeline.
Well, considering that I like don't drink anymore, that's like two drinks. I'm gonna have to pace myself because,
it's gonna get after you.
Either that or just like eat obscenely before.
So that's next Wednesday. Next Tuesday, I said we have Snack Chat, and there's the Record Shop Holiday Party, which is going to be on Twitch. We have something next Monday, too, I think, that was announced, right, through Heartfelt?
Not announced.
Oh, I thought it was announced. We got tagged in something.
Yeah, that wasn't it.
Okay. Right. Well, there's something else.
Well, yeah, there's something else on Monday that people will hear about.
All right.
Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, we're not doing Finish My Track.
No, we're off for a couple weeks.
But there's a release that day. What comes out that day?
That one is Feel Again with Shanahan is coming out next Friday. Christmas Eve, we're dropping a record. I'm sure it will be like the singular record that drops on Christmas Eve.
Crate Diggers is just going to be our record with Shanahan. That's it.
All the streams. So yeah, that's dropping next Friday, and then the Friday after that, which is New Year's Eve, we're dropping Get Fried Volume 4, which is gonna have the Shanahan single on it. It's also gonna have our collab with Smilo.
Yeah.
Super dope record, which is coming out as a single that day. And we're doing a live event in San Diego at Encore Event Center, which tickets are still available for if you guys wanna go pick those up.
Yeah. And that's going to be sick. There's a lot going on with Record Shop at that event, too, which is going to be cool.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot. They're on top of their game. They're pretty excited. Because, I mean, all those guys, that company started during the pandemic, and none of the people really have commingled. Like, it's all been virtual stuff.
Right,
so, like, they're going to be able to, like, party together and...
Are a lot of people, like, coming out?
Yeah, I think
Gotcha. Nice. That'll be cool, then.
I don't know anybody's flying in, but there's a lot of people in Southern California.
Already, like, based in,
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, Mike Smilo. You guys might have seen the picture of him and I last week. We ran into each other at Chuck E. Cheese kids' parties. That's how cool we are.
I haven't been inside of Chuck E. Cheese. I've been to, like, I did a birthday party at a bowling alley, but they had, like, an arcade, so it was, like, a Dave and Buster's type of feel.
That's basically what Chuck E. Cheese is now.
Yeah.
So they got rid of all like the ball pits, all the slides, and anything that people deemed disgusting, they just did away with. So now they just all fucking touch all the arcade games and shit. And it's the same film.
And the animatronics are gone, right?
No.
They still have
moving stage.
That's actually pretty awesome.
It felt like, so they had like a show, right, of the animatronics people, and then, like, there was a live Chuck E. Cheese guy. Mm-hmm. But then it was all synced with, like, video visuals and, like, 90s lighting. So it was like you were kind of in 2021.
Yeah, they, like, repurposed some of it and then refreshed other parts.
Yeah, you're, like, it's somewhere between 95 and 2021, but no in between. It was just very odd. That. Yeah. How do you know it was a guy in a costume? I don't. It could have been like, again, like a 2021 animatronic that was just really good mixed with 95 animatronics. So I don't know. Anyway, next week's going to be pretty awesome.
Yeah, man.
Let's jump into, we have a new segment we're going to try out right now. See how you guys like it. It's called Music News.
Yeah. All right. I don't think you need to touch the audio. I think that's
it.
That's it. Print it.
I meant it didn't even give me enough time to throw on. I just wanted some like smooth jazz behind this.
That's... Yeah, I thought when you said like news music, I thought you meant like CNN like breaking.
And initially, I was going for that, and then I was like, let me look up what would be on the news as they're doing their outro. Like they're talking out like, all right, we just talked about how like millions of people died and this and that. And it's like tragic news. And then they're like, so what are you doing this weekend, Phil? And it'll be like, you know, it parlays into like this feel good moment at the end.
Yep.
European music news. I have none of that. Nothing.
There's a playlist on Spotify. I know it.
Probably. All right. So first thing up, I'm just going to pull these up because I feel like it's a little more engaging.
Oh, pull it up on the screen.
Yeah. This deal is quite large.
Yeah. $500 million. So it's his publishing and the masters, which is why it's...
Yeah. And I believe it's the biggest one to date, right?
Yeah, because it said... What was it? $400 million last year was for... There was another artist that they bought the catalog.
That was Bob Dylan last year.
Bob Dylan, yeah.
So, I follow Bob Lefsetz's letters. I don't know if you read any of those.
Yeah, I do read those sometimes.
He had a really good hot take on this, that Springsteen's 72. For him to make this amount of money before he goes is unlikely, right. One. Yeah. Two, when he dies... Eventually, number one, the state of New Jersey is going to fold in half. They're not going to know what to do with themselves. And number two, his kids will have to deal with selling the catalog potentially.
Yeah.
And deal with higher estate taxes and things like that. So, yeah, it's quite an interesting move.
Yeah, man. Yo, Christo, we're about to roll into Dope or Nope, so stick around. Has Selko played any music on Dope or Nope?
Good question. I don't think he has.
I feel like he should. I think that's the move.
Yeah, I got to, you're supposed to pre-submit it because Hess has it all in a sheet. But if you put a link in right now, I will text it to him.
There you
see
go.
If he can get it in. Oh, that's our game show music. We didn't throw a junior into the fryer.
Yeah, I had some ready, but he just had so much like... I don't know. He had so many good stories that it wasn't the move.
So 300, you guys might know as the management hybrid management label company, was bought fully by Warner Music. It was distributed by Warner prior distribution deal to now a full acquisition. Why is this notable? It's interesting because this is going to happen way more often now, especially as the labels make more money. They're going to scoop up a lot of the labels you guys know and love as independent labels. They will get purchased and are getting purchased. And also the management companies and kind of like writer hybrid management companies getting bought by the labels. How does that change things? We don't know. For those artists on those platforms like 300, it could open up people to work with more major label artists. But I don't know how this is a benefit for the artist. I know it's a win for Warner. They're going to make a fuck ton of money.
Yeah. No, but I feel like consolidation never really helps out the artist.
No. More music can now be bought.
Exactly.
Yeah. Did have a really good Twitter spaces the other night with Blau.
I saw, like, after the fact, I saw a lot of people talking about that.
It was awesome, man. He's super smart, but it was like me, Cap Slap, Paper Diamond, Blau, Ollie, who was on our record, yep. Honey, and was part of that Blau deal. Just talking about like what music ownership looks like in a Web3 space. And we were talking about interesting stuff like you could own a certain render of a track. Like you might own the WAV file, but somebody else might own...
V1.
Yeah, and somebody might own the MP3. And what is that?
Oh, interesting.
What does that ownership look like? And just how long is it going to take for the legal system to catch up to define
laws? Yeah, there's so much to iron out.
Yeah, you got to go, man, right?
Well, and I don't want you to keep passing everyone else.
Yeah.
But well, that's crazy, you. Man. Maybe we'll get into it on the Record Shop and we can bring people up so they can offer their thoughts. I think the Record Shop community probably has a couple
opinions.
Things to say.
Yeah, I think they do.
If you stopped in Discord, you would know this.
Yeah. All right, guys, this is Finish My Track. Stick around. We're rolling right into Dope or Nope in a second. And that's it for today. Thank you.
Yes.
All right. There goes Danny. Yes, he's a part. You gotta have a fade out function.
I know. I would do that last week. This week. Coming week. We'll do a little transition.
I love
it. But for now, I'll just.
All right. Here we are. Welcome to Dope or Nope segment. I need a second, as always, to get adjusted here. Let me pull up Clubhouse. Hang on. There's gotta be a better way. Hold on. This is live, guys. This is live. All right, Hess, I need a minute, man. One moment. Clubhouse, Club Deck. All right, if you're seeing Hess talk, it's because we are simultaneously on Clubhouse right now, and I will be pulling up that feed momentarily. I'm waiting for it to load. It's coming back from the satellite. Here we go. And Dope or Nope.
His end.
Here he is.
I see his face. I don't hear him.
I'm here.
Yet.
I'm here. Ah,
hey, what's up, Nick?
How we doing, guys?
Push the button.
Rocking.
We're doing great. How are you doing?
Really well. Just wrapped up a really good stream with Junior Sanchez on Finish My Track.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, now we're here.
Oh, wow.
Amazing.
That's cool.
How did that go?
It was great. We haven't caught up in years, and it was just it was cool to hear what he's working on and just some of the history and some really good stories. Guy's got stories for days.
Yeah, he's a good dude.
He's got a lot of stories.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. A lot of stories. So if you're just joining us, again, it's Dope or Nope. Fresh electronic tunes that are released today and 30 minutes of demos. We are streaming on the Disco Fries on Twitch and Kramer BPM. And, yeah, shall we...
Most importantly, to me at least, is Clubhouse and all of our Clubhouse listeners who jump in every week. So thank you very much.
Matt Jones, DJ Spawn, Barkin. We have a lot of nice demos today, too.
So many.
Yeah. You saw that, right? Kind of crazy.
Test.
Mm-hmm. Oh, good afternoon. Austin Kramer is in the house. That was a very
shout
good
out
test.
Kosher Deals. What's up, Rami?
That was a big test.
All right.
All right, so the panel today, Nick Dietry from the Disco Fries, Lauren Padman, who will remain off camera, I'm assuming.
I'll set that up.
I was like, it's 7 in the morning, you're good. Like, I'm not going to bust you.
No, I'm getting it.
Lauren Padman, Vice President of Dimmock Records and all-around studio maven, Austin Kramer from Tomorrowland and Essentials and Monday... New music, so much stuff. Do you guys follow Austin out there in Clubland? You should, right? You have to be.
Everybody's got to follow Austin.
Everyone's got to follow him. And also, like, subscribe to his Twitch channel, too, because he's got stuff going on there as well. So let's start with some new stuff. What we're listening to right now, I'm just going to back it up a tiny bit. This is Jack Back, Citizen Kane, Kiko Waishara, and the song's called Super Cycle. Here we go. Dope or Nope.
Very progressive.
Yeah. Getta can do whatever he wants at this point.
Yeah.
So what do we think?
Nice one.
I like it. I mean, he is having a year or 10 years. I don't know. I mean, this year,
David Guetta has become so big that he's able to create another name and get away with the kind of music that he wanted to play before, or he was kind of half making really before he went commercial, really. Very clever.
Yeah. And he just keeps going.
Yeah.
And he just keeps, but he's still putting out hits, right? He still does that part too.
Yeah.
This next one, big fan. Big fan of the artist too. Wolfgang Gartner. Very simply, this is Mike Tyson. And you're listening to Dope or Nope.
One shot to the head.
Mike Tyson.
Yay or nay?
Love
wow.
Some, love some
that was very cool.
Love it.
So good. When's the last time you put a record out? I feel like it's been so long.
Yeah, it's been the longest time. I feel like we were talking about this or something like this. One of the, like, where is he? What is he doing? And yeah, right? Here we are. This is great. What
a few weeks ago.
Great comeback.
And then, Hess, you're working this record, right?
This one?
Or no?
No. I'm just such a fan. I love Joey's awesome.
Yeah, I was gonna throw it in, but I realized is it on Republic?
Which one? Wait, which one?
This one.
This record.
This is on. Really? Let me look.
This is Alt Vision Records.
Alt Vision. Really good. Yeah. What label's that? Is that his own?
I thought they had a deal with Casablanca or distribution or something.
Oh, neat.
All you music guys talking about labels and stuff.
I think it's
just
interesting.
About the tune. Is it a good song?
It is.
Yeah.
But I think it's also interesting to see like what labels are doing and when they see stuff, how the, you know, do they create things or do they just purchase them?
Yeah.
Austin, you put Hyperlogic and Pura Purpa.
I put this in for two reasons. A, it's a cover of U2, and Lorne is the world's biggest U2 fan.
At least.
So this one's for him. And I like saying Pura Purpa.
You said it, you said it a lot better than I do. Okay.
I'm not
so here we go. This is,
did I?
This is only me.
I don't know what the song is, and I don't know what the name is, and it's not a U2 song, so as soon as I figure it out, I'll shout it out and hit it.
All right, here we go. You're listening to Dope or Nope on Clubhouse. And Hyperlogic. Lost. Found it.
New Year's Day. Finally.
I know, I was trying to read your face.
It wasn't very impressive.
I do know that I'll never play poker with you at this point. I don't know, that's fun.
Yeah, it is. It's fun. It's fun. It kind of reminds me of something from... I remember there was some of the record in the 90s that was kind of like that. It was just a small female vocal sample, just chugged along, and then used a really big sample in the... like a recognizable sample in the breakdown only, but not in the drop, not in the build, not in the verses, like not pre, anywhere, just in the breakdown only. And I can't say I've heard that again. Like, it's really rare to use just a sample only in the breakdown. The last time I remember it was Avicii Levels, actually.
Right.
Like, it's so just rare.
It's such a cool move, though. Like,
Do you pay less when you use a sample like that? No, that's right.
You could argue to pay less. You can argue to say that I'm that it's not the main premise of the song, but then they would come back and say, but it's the payoff of the song. And then you'd say, well, it's not the driving hook of the song. And then they say, yes, but is it the reason that a person's listening to the song? So it becomes like a negotiation.
Right.
Which the publisher
will always win.
Well, I was just curious, though. You know, what happens? Use it like differently like that.
I also love how Lauren talks about it as if he's had this conversation a few times.
Yeah. What's the story?
Yeah.
Wait, I just want to know from which side of that.
From both sides, actually, from both sides. But like with Avicii specifically, we had to argue for him for, which song was it? Which one was it?
Was it Street Dancer?
It was a Cassius. No, it wasn't. Yes, that's right. Street Dancer. Exactly. It was Street Dancer. It was a whistle. It was a whistle and Street Dancer, because it was effectively just a little bit of a breakdown build thing, that it wasn't over the drops, and it become like a, we only want this for this little thing. But another record from Avicii had come out just before, and then they argued. They sort of said, yeah, but this is what he does, so we want more, and it has become this big thing. So what I learned is, the takeaway is this, for all the producers out there and rappers alike, like my man Kosher Dills, who's tuning in here, the trick is, ask early, don't ask later, don't ask after the record's already out or it's just about to be out or something like that. Like, request it when nobody really knows whether it's even going to be a thing, and you can kind of bluff whether you're going to use it at all. Once the song's out, like say, like it was for Gautier, when he put out his big record that took out the world, that you didn't need to cut me off, that he never asked for that guitar sample, the ding, 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 ding. Like, he could have replayed in 3 minutes, but he didn't. And then when he got around to asking for it, the song was already out, and they said, well, we'll take 50% of the record.
Wow.
Yeesh.
And he lost 50% of the song on the master and the publishing, and he could 50%. Have asked for it, requested wow. it, and got like, you know, 10, 20, something more reasonable. So yeah, ask early up front, and if you're really attached to the record, attached to the sample, and you can't possibly not have it, then if they hold out, then, you know, you're going to probably pay 50% of your record, maybe even 100%. Some people will say, yeah, we understand, but the sample's so big, we're taking 100% of the publishing. And if you don't like it, then don't use that sample.
So it's the opposite of that old adage.
Yeah, there's a
better
site.
Better to ask for forgiveness, that one.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't work at all. It's the opposite. Yeah.
There's a site called Tracklib we're big fans of. Tracklib is basically like the Splice of sample clearance, and they have like a massive catalog of music on there where you could just go and sample dig, and then they have pricing structures based on what you want to use. If you want to use 6 seconds, it's this price. If you want to use 15 right. seconds, it's this price. And they automatically clear it for you and help you with the registration. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. That's nice. Yeah, TrackLib is great. As a label at Denmark, they've come to us and said, hey, can we basically license a bunch of your things already? So they have the negotiation with us, and then we decide which ones that we feel should be category A, B, or C, and then we sign it to them, and then we have no control over whether it actually comes out or not, because it's already been pre-cleared, to your point, which is awesome. Awesome for everybody, because again, it's, you know, decided upon beforehand, sort of thing.
Cool. All right, next
just
one.
Just a side note, I was sweating pretty hard during that track because I thought it had a lot more of the U2 hook. And I was like, I might have screwed this up. I just had to say that. It's like, oh, thank God for that.
Wait for it. At least it happened. There you go.
I appreciate the sentiment, Austin. Thank you, man.
This next one is Zoo, Party with Ray, the Jay Wara remix. It's called Zoodio 54. I don't know if you guys have heard this, but Jay Wara's remix is really good. Here we go. On the floor tonight, work here on the floor tonight. It's on the floor tonight. Fashion on the floor tonight. Thoughts?
I like it. It was cool. Really good, good bass line. Good driving vibe. Very cool.
Yeah, I really like the track. Remix is good. Was there an original? Did I miss this?
Yeah.
Austin, how was the original compared to that?
Less swingy, but definitely more zooey. But this kind of holds that. There's three remixes. I preferred the Bijou, but this is, I think they're all super holding on that zoo feeling.
Right.
Which as the years pass, I realize how more innovative that kid was in the early days. Because now people are sort of ripping that off, but it's super unique. That like, you know, falsetto male. You hear it more and more.
Nick.
The Jay Wara has 270K spins after 2 weeks, so pretty good.
Yeah, that's not bad.
I guess 1 week.
Yeah, I love this record. Party with Ray's a buddy, and
oh, nice.
He does really good work, and yeah, I've been on Zoo since the beginning when Jake from Third Brain was managing him, and they were just starting to break him. I've always loved his sound. Really good stuff.
Jack Udell.
Nice.
Jack Udell. Yep.
Nick, you actually put one in today. My Mind by DJ Augie and Danielle Oda. What is that?
Yeah, so Augie dropped this one as a demo in our Finish My Track live stream like 2 months ago, and then he came to us with it, and we helped him polish it up a little bit, and it just came out today on the label. Guy's a super hard worker. Track's catchy as hell, and this is one of his first official releases, so happy to be a part of it.
All right, let's check it out. This is called My Mind on Liftoff. You're listening to Dope or Nope on Clubhouse. Here we go. I don't want to.
Good record. That's cool. Not bad at all.
Really nice.
Yeah.
Today on Liftoff.
I love DJ. These guys.
Very hard to A&R anything that comes out on Liftoff. I wonder why that is. I think it's because it's been A&R'd before already.
I think because it's finished.
Yeah, because it's gone through a process of being finished.
Finished.
How does Liftoff have finished? All the finished records?
Yeah.
Guys, I'm going to take this clip.
How would you do that? How would you do that? Would you have to go to like finishmytrack.com to get that done? I feel like...
I think so.
I don't know. It just feels like it's very finished. I just wanted to reference that it sounds great.
But is it finished? All right.
Yeah. Super finished.
Super.
Very nice. Very cool. Good record.
All right. We'll keep moving forward.
Good record for what it is. You know, really nice, just cruisy. It's not trying to be funk, and it's not trying to be too lazy, and it's not trying to be too uplifting. It's just this beautiful in the pocket, you know, nice record for what it's doing.
I love these guys who come on every week and like, and in here too, like people we see show up that are working every week and dropping new tracks in. It's pretty inspiring.
Yeah. Speaking of that, quick shout out to DJ Spawn, Mr. Pressman's in. Thank you, sir. I know it's pretty late there. Mune, Bad Monkey, Barkin, Atrium. Who else? HD was here a couple minutes ago. There he is. Parth. Yeah, we got a lot of our the regulars. So
shout out to arguably the greatest freestyle rapper that I've ever met and I've ever heard of, Kosher Deals. I've mentioned that he's here, but
Rami.
Kosher Deals happens to be Rami. Yeah, happens to be one of the greatest freestyle rappers that of all time, and this guy hustles, and he had a huge breakout moment with Fat Joe this year, which I'm really excited for him. What's up, Rami? You're a good dude. I'm glad that you're having your moment in the sun, and I'm looking forward to seeing you in LA when I ever get back, which is I guess mid-January now that I'm stuck here in Sydney. I mean, I can't say stuck because it's pretty awesome, but anyway.
Right.
It's just very early.
Stuck in Sydney. That doesn't even go together.
Yeah. Anyway, sorry. I know we have to keep moving.
Oh, good. Cascade, The Moth and the Flame, and this is called Ice V3.
Anti-drop.
I mean, were we all just waiting for the thing to smash and then...
Yeah, and instead it just goes into a nice little grooving chug.
Yeah, which I also like. Super cool. Everyone in on that?
Very not Cascade. That was awesome.
Yeah. I don't know. Is this another... Just something else he's doing or... feels?
He's on
it
a
could
run,
be another
right?
pivot.
Well, there's been V3s in the last few weeks, I think.
Oh, some others?
Yeah, I thought I saw V Lessons in Love, Turn It Down. I guess he's cascading them throughout the weeks.
Oh, see what you did there.
Very nice.
See what you did there. I have to go back and listen to those. Yeah.
Yeah.
Turn It
this
Down,
is cool.
Lessons in Love. Yeah, nice. One more before we hit the demos. Blue Claire and Cayenne Gills, and this is called Chemistry. Really like that groove. Yeah, I have to listen to the list. Awesome. It's comes from an EP. It's called the Prelude EP. There's one, two, three. There's six. On today's terms, that's actually an album. That's on Insomniac Records. Really nice piece.
All right. Yeah, it's cool. Very house.
Yeah, I don't know Blue Clare before this.
Not
anyone
really.
Else? Yeah. Do you?
Yeah. Not familiar.
Yeah, I do. I am familiar. I've seen a few Blue Clare records come up. I want to say it's in our A&R discussion as well, actually, over the last few months at Denmark. I was trying to find it because Denmark are launching a sub label called A Good One as a house label. We've put out a few records, but it's been kind of soft at this point. So 2022, we're going to be trying to do more. House records.
Interesting. It's called A Good One.
So that, yeah, it's called A Good One. Yeah, I didn't choose the name, but the name's been chosen. So
it's a good name.
Oh, so sort of like, oh, that's such a good one. Got it.
Right.
Like, oh, he was on a good
very,
one.
It's very kind of kitsch UK humor. I remember there was a management company called Good Question. And I said, how did you come up with that? It's like, well, we're all sitting around and everybody would say something and everybody were like, oh, yeah, good question. And we just noticed that was the vernacular, so we went through it.
Right. Is that where you came up with finish your track?
Yeah,
finish my track?
That was a same deal. We were like, oh, Lauren, with the idea of track finishers. We were finishing other people's tracks. Well, finish my track. Boom. Online, like URL at 1 a.m. I was like, nobody owns this. Score.
No one owns finish my track. Are you kidding? Take my $7.99.
Yeah, for the next 20 years, take my $7, please.
Right. Exactly. All right. So, in case you just joined us, welcome to Dope or Nope. This is the demo 30 minutes. Thanks for joining us. We have a lot of demos today. Really appreciate it. You're listening on Clubhouse, on Twitch, YouTube, Facebook. We're just kind of everywhere right now. First one up is JMCX, and this is called Recovery.
Baby, I see you and me walking through recovery. Could you let that be today? Walking through recovery.
So this is something that I remember hearing in Moscow about 10 years ago. And right. this kind of bass line, sort of thing. And that really very, I can't describe it as any other thing except for like a very Euro synth in the last half of the drop. Yeah. So to our ears, that sounds overtly commercial and right smack bang over into the commercial land. Very cheesy sort of thing. But in Eastern Europe, that's like straight down the middle, perfect dance floor material. So I just wanted to point out that as much as like my stomach turns a little bit when I hear music like that, I know that there's a huge market for it and it would
absolutely.
Be great.
Absolutely. I get these on our, you know, I hear this pretty regularly. And also I want to say like there's a little bit of like Germany in there and like a couple other territories that are similar. All right. So next up.
I love those bird sounds.
Is that in the record?
Oh, my bird sounds. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, okay. I'm not on mute. There's a couple of birds outside the window. It's very cool.
I was like, go
Australia, go Sydney.
That would be so perfect if we're on the record. Barkin and Von Boyage, Last Time Groovin', right here on Doper Note.
Yeah, I wasn't super hot on like the build. It wasn't the most exciting thing, and then when I got here, I was re-engaged.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That part was nice. I wasn't taking the sort of vocal sample thing going on there.
Yeah, same.
Yeah.
It didn't really do it for me.
Maybe because it was two times in a row, but I really like the track.
It runs out of ideas, doesn't it? A little bit.
Right. Up until then.
The vocal sample.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's nice
though. If the producer of this record was listening, trying to sound like we're shitting on records, because that's not our intention. Our intention is to make songs better. So we would say, as a collective, was that vocal sample compelling? And the answer is no, it wasn't compelling. So therefore, find something else that is compelling, or is a hook whereby you'd say, oh, have you heard that latest song that just came out by so-and-so? You know, the one that does... And it probably wouldn't be, I'm so afraid or whatever. It's not hooky enough or strong enough to be memorable. So find another vocal sample. But the instrumental of that was actually kind of cool.
Right. Barkin is actually in Clubhouse. So
And Twitch.
Perfect. Ah, there we go.
Great.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, you're almost there. Really
all right. Nice. Next one up is Trey. And this is called Let Me Go. It says extended, but it's 4 minutes. I'll bounce around if we need to. Here we go.
Here's Steve Aoki drums.
All right.
Thank you.
gonna move it. Whoa. Here we go.
Have a go at this one,
please.
So the song's basically built around a drop, and the drop's actually really good. I like how the bass line was semi following the lead but wasn't exactly. It was kind of nice, and the kicks were cool, and there's enough space in the percussion because there wasn't very much percussion. The big brass lead was really nice. But I mean, this is obviously for anybody who's into hard house, of course, but that's what it was doing.
Right.
But the vocal sample wasn't really that exciting. Again, back to that compelling word. It didn't really sort of felt glued into it, merged well. And also, it's a huge, big, one of those records where the DJ mixes it in and then there's a big explosion that explodes down for almost 4 bar, and then it comes back with something, and it better come back with something which is totally worth your time. And it just wasn't. That part was the part that wasn't worth the time. And I can just almost feel the room sort of like listening, going, okay, what's next? Okay, is it going to get somewhere? And then the next thing that came in were these really beautiful chords. The chords were kind of reminded me of around the Avicii era of chords. But those chords are always at the back of the mix doing something, and something else more memorable or compelling is on the top, and it just wasn't there again. So I don't think the vocal sample is enough to drive the song. It probably needs like a full vocal or something else that's more diva-esque or something like that. But the drop was really cool, and everything before it was waiting for the drop.
Right.
I think it'd score well in a workout situation, or like a Soul Cycle or a Peloton or something. Other than that, Lauren's right. There's nothing animals about it. There's no, right. We need a drop in there somewhere.
And also something that you'll remember later. The most I can think is like that bum, 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 is something I've heard a lot of.
Yeah. It would actually be worth, to Austin's point, going back to listen to Martin Garrix's Animals and try to figure out what makes that good when it's not a drop. Because that record, I think we've spoken about before, was finished for 18 months and was waiting for release before someone came up with we need something to make this song memorable. And then they found that, pitched down motherfucking animals sort of sample, and then it was able to be shared because it came out. It's like, everyone's heard the animal song. Oh, yeah, I love that song. And they remember the rest of the instrumental. But going back to it, try to figure out what's a good vocal sample, or honestly, why is that record so good when it's not the drop? Because this demo is missing that half.
Right. There you go. Up next, Galaxy, The Dark Week. And this is mastered, I guess. Okay, here we go. This is Dope or Nope, and you're listening to the demo section. Right here on Clubhouse. like this section and the beginning. I thought the build into this section was twice as long as it should have been.
That sounds familiar.
Right.
That,
I've been
given or
that advice if it, now for 20
if it,
years.
If it was going to be that long, it's just got to be more dynamic to get here.
Right.
Drop has cool
listen,
ideas.
When we got there, it's great.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, getting there was great. That's what I'm saying. But when you're listening on, you know, if this is out and you're listening on your favorite platform, will you get there? Will you spend the minute and 9 seconds, right? So that's
a long
right
time.
There.
You need to be there by 45 seconds.
Right. So there was this piece about 30 seconds that should have gone. Well, there you have it. That's a Galaxy with the Dark Week. You're listening to Dope or Nope. You're on Clubhouse, Twitch, Facebook, and YouTube. Our illustrious panel today. Just give them a round of applause, silently, of course.
Oh, come on, stop.
And don't forget to follow them wherever they go.
Visit me in Australia.
Come to visit him in Australia. I didn't realize that your hair isn't quite as high at 7 in the morning.
No, it's flat at 7 in the morning.
I just want
to what it looks
that.
Like when I'm about to go gardening.
That's what
knows.
She said. Oh. That's what she said.
Oh.
Oh.
Yeah. So, on that note, we're going to listen to a little Bad Monkey and welcome home.
That's a really good idea, what was going on there.
All done in one
that
minute.
Was really, yeah, well, that's appreciated. It's a really good idea, but Nick, help me out here. That didn't sound glued in, and I think
Agreed. It
was because it wasn't quantized or something. It just felt like that, as if something wasn't exactly on grid. Two noises are trying to play the same melody, but one was ever so slightly off or something.
Yeah, and I think there was an issue with the groove in the top end of the percussion. Like, there's some funky rhythm stuff going on with the hi-hats that were kind of conflicting against the groove of the synths.
Right.
I love the ideas that are there. I think there's something really, like, fresh and cool about all this stuff. But it's the way it hits, too. Like, the mix is not quite there. Missing some.
So,
like,
yeah, it sounds like it was swinging. The swing was either too much or something was stuck on the off and something was on the downbeat. And it was like that kind of thing. Like that's where I would start looking for how to fix that. Like, and also everything, I wondered whether it would be better if only one sound came in instead of two at the drop initially. I wondered if that was worth trying, but
common problem, right.
You know what I appreciate
good idea,
most about
almost.
What we do? When you guys say all this, what you just did,
my
brain goes, I hear that and I go, and then you answered my question.
Well, I'm glad we're here for you.
Yeah, we're here for you. Absolutely, Hess. Whatever you need, George.
Just saying. I'm like, what could be better?
You know what's amazing? Like, from a mix perspective, I didn't think, like, the drums hit the right spot. But sometimes it's fixed with just swapping out a kick drum. Like, you could literally swap a kick drum and it could fix your record. Not saying we've done that, but we've done that.
Yeah. And you've waited 2 days and come back and said, yeah, we worked on your track a lot.
Nick, which change
my
which
track
kick
in
would you
5 minutes
with?
.com.
I don't know what kick I would go with, but I would definitely go for something that has a little more low end and it's a little snappier.
I bet you have a kick in one of those packs you sell. There is a nice
pack sitting on finishmytrack.com right now.
Of course there is.
Discount code Friends of Fries. Have fun.
Oh.
Friends of Fries. Boom.
It's all right there here. Right here today. This next one is called Colors by, I want to say Bogus. 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 Yeah, we'll go with Bogus. Here we go.
Your voice is a navy ocean bed I sink into when you say my name. Making it easy for me to fall. Your body's a work of art. I wanna paint just the shades of all the colors that you are.
Hey,
wait a minute.
Wait, don't turn it on yet. Not yet. Turn it back up.
I'm at the cash register right here.
That's
what do we got?
Pete.
All right, boys. I'll arm wrestle you for this one.
Go ahead.
This is great.
Love it.
This is great. Like, the really good drop. I have an idea how to improve it ever so slightly. It would be, controversially, it would be to have her sing the low harmony and stick that in to make it seem a little bit less airy. To match the bottom end, that would be my only real massive change of sorts, because it's so good, but it's her vocals slightly doesn't dare I say it doesn't quite match the track slightly. But the way to make it match the track, because I had the same problem with Aviella recently, is if it's a thin high voice, you just need a lower depth to anchor it. And this is what I would do to change this track. But oh my lord, this drop. Wow. I'm watching on our online and watching all of our faces at the same time. It was one of those moments. Great.
Exactly.
Congratulations. This is great.
Forlorn vocoder works too. Could easily do a vocoder.
Yes.
Layer,
and perfect.
That could kind of like give you the feeling of that drop sound and just kind of layer that under the vocal. That could sound really cool.
Yeah.
Nice work.
Really nice track though, right?
Awesome.
Really good.
Very.
That's the dope so far for me.
So what was that? Back announce it, please.
Sure. That was Bogus with Colors. B-O-G-E-S.
Colors.
Yeah. Let me back this up a little bit. This is Reverse with Upside Down.
If you call yourself Bogus, that means you can weather any feedback anyone will ever give you in the music industry.
Send that record to me.
All right, here we go.
I've blown your kiss, but ain't getting back. I feel that I miss. It's a light heart attack, baby. Knowing that you're tense, a little bit stressed, honey. You're making me some mess, but I can't live without it.
Once in a while, the people just throw ringers in here. It's not me.
What do you mean?
I love that track.
What do you mean?
By the way, all that got done in like 57 seconds. 57 seconds.
Oh, yeah, good point.
Literally heard the whole thing. You're like, I'm in, tell me more.
I love that. Mm-hmm. I was hoping for the one thing when that drop, everything was perfect. Vocals awesome, mix is great.
Right.
The drop energy is great, but I wanted a little melody to happen. Some kind of like ethereal melody to hit when the drop hit.
Right. Yeah. Nice. Yeah.
Can we sample that?
Yeah. So like what's that called? It's a counter melody, right?
Counter melody. Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Now that I'm in Australia, my Australian accent comes all the way out. Counter melody.
A canter. What is that?
As opposed to a counter melody.
Counter. You know, like a countertop.
Counter.
What do you say? A countertop.
I don't know how you guys do it without hurting the back of your mouth.
Counter
stuff.
Countertop.
So once again, that was reverse counter. With upside down. Oh, Lauren's already tagged. Which one did you tag? Okay. Yep. So by the way, there's quite a few. Deliveries on the list today, 1, 2, 3, that say they are signed already. This, so when you submit in this part, just as a reminder, this is the unsigned demo section. So I'm skipping those.
By the way, quick congratulations to Versu, who's a regular on here, signed a record to Liftoff this week.
Nice.
Congrats to Versu. Thanks for showing up.
Nice one. What do we got next? Nope, not that one. This is Rock Oz, and this is called Sarm 20. And you are listening to Dope or Nope on Clubhouse, the demo section.
Good production.
Yeah, it was really good. You have any comments like better it? What makes it better?
I like the bottom end. I like the bass line and the percussion, I think, is pretty strong. I think there was a little female vocal sample, I want to say, that was in there that needed to be turned up and maybe expanded upon, replaced. I think that you can't just leave it to hoping that the wind instrument in the drop is going to be the compelling part. I think that's more of a supporting thing.
Right.
So you're still missing the compelling piece at the moment. You're almost there, but you need some idea.
Uh-oh.
Some other idea to be the hook. So,
right.
There you go.
I agree. Needed to be in combination with something else. 100%.
Yeah, right.
All right. Anyone else before I go to the next one?
There's a site called soundbetter.com, super dope site where you can hire musicians and vocalists and stuff. I would recommend going there and seeing if you could get somebody to play that woodwind instrument. I think it was some kind of flute. Play a part that's a little more interesting than what you have there, but same type of vibe. And that way it could carry the drop. And you might also want to like hold that flute for the drop versus having it just roll through the majority of the record. That would be my couple thoughts to consider.
That's a great idea. All right, next one up. This is Kazaa Don't Stop, a regular here on Dope or Nope. Edgar. Thank you for dropping this off. In all fairness, that this track is 5:48, so there's a lot.
Just as you started to fade that out, okay, just turn it up right here for a second, the vocal. That part, that I was thinking should have come in first in the drop, because it would make it cooler, because it instantly went into a really cool drop, and then I thought, and it's using that pitched up kind of vocal sample, and I thought, oh geez, that's pretty cheesy. I wonder this if you could right remove here. That. Yeah. Right. I mean, where it is now in a build, it's fine. But in 8,
right here,
hold for it, wait, and here, that should have been down, pitched right. Down, the other way around. And then the next one, if you think that it doesn't work to be again down, or it doesn't work to be up, then you make a chop up of it or make some other variation. But to make it cool, it should have gone down, not up. Anyway, great house record, kind of not too far away from a night bass record. It's got that really cool bottom end groove to it. Nick, does that sound right to you? The groove seems right.
Yeah, seems good here. I think you hit the nail on the head. Thought it was cool.
That was good easy. Song.
Next up, George, and this is Even If.
Nice intro.
To here is a minute.
Wow.
Right. May not feel
that's like minute. Putting a beat under an acapella to make it easier for a DJ to play an acapella. That's what it kind of sounded like to me.
Yeah, I actually like the drop a lot. Like, I think the idea is really cool. I think the whole thing is missing automation. There's no like moment.
Oh, explain that.
Like just in the beginning, if you're gonna have like drums and just a vocal, totally fine to do that. And the automation I heard of the vocal filtering in was dope. But then like when the drums stop, the clap just cuts off, versus them kind of sending out to a reverb or a delay and filtering out, high passing out or something. Like there's no little moments to create crescendos and decrescendos and all these dynamics. because everything just kind of like rides. Like it sounds like a loop starts and a loop stops.
Mm. Yeah.
That was over my head.
So, yeah, maybe some like way of making it feel a little muffled as well. Like some using low pass filters could be helpful.
Yeah, just to go a step further so Hess understands what I mean. In a rec, like,
and therefore 90% of the audience.
Yeah, like if you're on a DJ mixer, right, and you're riding like a filter knob over the course of 8 bars or 16 bars, something's high passing out as something's filtering in.
Okay,
right.
Or like a reverb slowly sending a sound out into space versus it just staying stagnant and cutting off at the end of a phrase.
Okay, that I understand.
It's tough for me to explain this any other way.
Yeah,
Lauren, thanks.
The best way to describe it is the way that you started, where you just basically said, imagine if you were DJing live on stage and DJs like to get their elbows like as up as high as possible to make it look like they're doing something on the mixer that's extraordinarily difficult when really it's not. Right. Or sometimes they do the chicken where they get both elbows up to
that's my favorite.
It's right. It's whatever that you would think could be cool to do to the record without overdoing it and giving the actual DJ nothing to do because it's already been done. That's right. What I would say you needs to be happening, which is basically just filters of high pass, low pass, combinations of that, maybe a light flange in some areas, things like that.
I'd also like to give that move now a name.
I like the chicken arm reference. The chicken arm.
Chicken arms.
We have to think of like the song. What, like, there needs to be a title for that because it's really like one and then two together.
Get your DJ chicken arms up.
Chicken arms.
It just seems so ridiculous.
Kind of like chicken legs, but I won't
shit on this particular DJ who's a very, very massive international DJ that everybody knows. But I watched I won't name check him. It's not fair because it was really dumb. I watched him in Amsterdam come on, get announced, and then the drop came and he ran his hand over every pot on the mixer and then on the city to the right and the second city to the right as if there was adjustments to be made when those two CD players weren't even being used at all. It was the CD way on the left that pressed play on and he was making every adjustment all over and I was like, what are you doing? Like, I don't get it. It honestly made no sense to me. So anyway, it was just a thing that I see DJs do where they're, you know, sure, if you want to make some adjustment, cool, make it, but don't do the chicken arms if you can avoid
chicken
it.
Arms. Chicken
Who
arms.
Was that?
I don't know if I should mention.
Don't do it.
Yeah, I don't think it's appropriate. Text me.
All right, speaking of Versu, this one is called Paradise, and that's not the one that's coming out, right? Nick?
What's that?
What's the song?
The one that's coming out is called Splash. Okay. So that's not going to be out until 2022.
All right. Just
Nick was in a dream trying to imagine which DJ.
No, I was texting you.
It's about 20 DJs.
He was texting.
I was texting you.
Okay, I'll put it in that chat.
All right, this is Versu with Paradise. This is extended, so I'm going to bounce a little bit. Oh. There'll be no name dropping on the over. We'll be right back.
This is cool.
Yeah.
This is a nice record. I don't really, there's nothing really wrong with it. It's really nice. Super nice.
That's what I like to call a groover.
A groover?
Groover indeed.
Super cool.
That would have gone in the old groover playlist back in the old days, wouldn't it, Austin?
Groover.
Groover.
The groover.
Yeah,
this is a nice record. That's a nice
too,
song.
Yeah. So that was back with that, Paradise. Versuit
yeah,
and
nice.
Paradise. It's
beautiful.
pretty long. So.
So Nick didn't sign this one. I'm confused now.
Mm-hmm. That means the other one must be much better and also finished.
Correct. You are correct.
Dick, correct us if we're wrong. Are they the same vibe?
Not quite.
That was awfully proggy. I love it.
That one was nice.
Very Dead Mouse-ish.
It was. Some Mune in the chat said that.
Oh, nice. Yeah, look at that. Old mate.
Yeah, Mune actually put a song up today, but it says it's released. If that's incorrect, let us know and I'll play it. Otherwise,
it's released?
Yeah. It says yes. I make a column for that part, and he answered.
Oh.
Hold on. Wait. Yeah, he put yes next to it. So let's go with Dave Suarez, and this is called Soulmate. This is also extended, so I'll bounce around. You're listening to Dope or Nope, demo time.
I was going to say something kind of facetious, like, you know, let me know when it started. And then I thought, hang on, but why am I thinking that? And it's because the uplifter goes into the drop and then continues, and it makes it feel like the drop itself is still lifting. So that's actually kind of clever.
Agreed. I love that trick.
Cool trick and a rare trick.
But I also feel like it could do something else.
I don't disagree with that. I was but I will say, as a compliment, this is the most nerd thing ever, but I really appreciate the gate of the snare reverb cutting off on each kick. It was very punchy, and I love that.
The gate?
There's like,
say
a
it again. Sorry, my brain's not
there's
happening.
A snare, like a slight snare reverb. And it closes like right as the kick hits, and the way he programmed that, if he did intentionally do it, which I assume he did, it sounds just really sharp, and it makes the drum sound super punchy.
Oh, I think I know why. This is the idea of closing a sound with just a small section of, let's call it silence or gap before the thing, which makes the thing sound like it's really snappy.
Yep.
So Hess, for example, if a build was going bang, bang, bang versus going bang, bang, there's like that little gap of snap or something in between that gives the drop much more definition in the attack, the speed of which the thing hits. So yeah, that's a really, really nerdy, Nick. Like, honestly, that's like
nerdy.
The nerdiest thing I've heard you say.
So I got
the gate on the reverb of the snare. You know what? I think that's the most nerdy thing I've ever heard you say. It's very impressive.
I remember using this trick because Tommy Sunshine told us about it when we first started working with him. And then, Lauren, I think you mentioned it at some point, is when you use that trick before a drop, it gives the limiter, it gives the limiter in a club a second to reset. So the threshold on the limiter comes back up. So when the drop hits, it's more impactful.
Yeah, for at least one kick.
Yeah, for one
before kick. Before it sucks it up again.
That's all you need it for. Yeah.
That's all you need, sometimes two.
All right, the nerd talk is over.
Yeah.
I'm done.
Wow.
All right.
That one also sounded like it might have been the internet slowing down, which I liked.
Right.
Maybe it could be sped up. We should speed this thing up like 8 BPM.
Yeah, it could. Yeah, you're right. It could feel a little bit more exciting if it wasn't so mid-tempo feeling. Which might cost you like, I don't know, 4 BPM maybe. Could be cool.
Yeah, I'm gonna throw one nerd thing in, right? So you know, this part here where it feels like it's building, right?
Yeah.
So it feels like the drop happened.
Yes.
But there's that one part that is still going.
Yeah.
Up.
Yeah.
But the other part's staying like sort of straight.
Yeah,
my layman's way to explain it.
What are you? You're explaining what?
I actually like it. It's sort of the contrast is really interesting, and then this.
You're right.
Where the uplift disappears.
Right.
And then there's an introduction of a really beautiful synth melody, like almost a counter melody, which is introduced for the first time, makes you feel like you're drifting, kind of like Mune records, actually. Mune records do that a lot.
Well, we're going to get there in 1 second. I have one demo left. This is Hoax, Vision of You.
I thought I was trying to set you up there.
Yeah, no, it's coming. It's coming, it's coming. Here we go. Vision of You by Hoax.
The city is a savior, she'll hold you till you're braver.
Hey, we know this vocal.
It's really good.
Yeah.
I take it back. I just thought the front of that vocal sounded in the very exact same as this older record. The same exact pitch.
What is that song? Wow. Yeah, I'm up too early for this. It needs to be later in my day for me to figure out things like that.
Nice, though. That's Vision of You by Hoax. And so we come to the conclusion of that section. And now we're going to play the Mune record. So, but anyway, real quick, thank you for joining us. Dope or Nope. Sweeter than honey when you keep this is Mune. And Slender Bodies. Song's called Sweater. I don't ever mind when I.
I'm looking for you, 'cause I want you.
Nice.
I like that. Really, you know, nice. That reminds me of, I don't know if you guys remember Postal Service.
No.
Postal Service was like a duo from, what is it, like early 2000s? Mid 2000s?
No, I don't remember.
In that,
no,
in that vibe
to look
a little
that up
bit.
Now.
Yeah.
Oh, all right. So,
yeah, it was good.
That was Mute.
Really nice.
And Slender Bodies with Sweater. So I think we've covered a lot of stuff today. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, wow. Some really good stuff. But yeah, we're way over. Bogus, still my favorite. Reverse, well, maybe that's a tie for me. I don't know. Mm-hmm. What do you guys think?
Yeah, that Bogus record was awesome. Oh. It's so weird to say. The Bogus record was awesome.
The Bogus record was awesome. Exactly.
Yeah,
okay, you've been listening to Dope or Nope on Clubhouse, Twitch, YouTube, Facebook, everywhere that the internet reaches, whether you like it or not. Thank you for the panel today. Austin Kramer, did he come back? I just saw a blank spot there. Is he back? Oh,
are you back? Austin? Yep.
Austin, hey, what do you got planned for the weekend with the big microphone?
You like my mic flag? I'm going to put some fertilizer on my new bushes.
What new bushes do you have?
I don't.
Even more Calusias, the magnificent number. The apple pitch.
Very nice. Very good. You have the standing approval for Calusias.
Thank you. And we're sending Christmas cards.
Oh, nice. Beautiful.
What are you guys up to?
Well, I have a lemon.
I'm going to walk outside.
Yeah, smart man. Austin, I have a lemon tree.
Australia.
A lemon tree that I brought inside 2 weeks ago because it got super cold here, and it's got like 300 blooms on it now, and I think it's tricked, thinking it's 70 degrees at all times because it's inside. So.
Uh oh. Right. Nice. Well, that's good. That's how to make
just
lemons
roll
in winter.
Yep.
You know what they say? You can make lemons out of lemonade or something.
Nope. No. Other way around.
Yep. Other way.
No. I want to go back to the fertilizer in the bushes joke that everyone else was thinking, Nick. Thank you for
mind
that.
Mind in the gutter. What?
I mean, if it were anyone else, anything. I would have said something, but I know Austin was really thinking bushes and fertilizer.
Yeah, so was lawn, actually.
Outside
Listen,
walk.
If a man can't fertilize his bushes, then I don't know what he can do.
I mean, and
a
weekend's a good time to do that, by the way.
Then are they, in fact, his bushes at all?
Well, he said new bushes. That's why I was a little disturbed.
Right. Wow.
Anyway, Aaron, what are you doing?
Taller team aside, what am I doing? I'm in Australia for the first time in 2 years, so I am freaking stoked to be here. I'm so excited. I've seen my girlfriend Brooklyn's parents. And now it's the weekend. I'm in Bondi, about a 7 minute walk from Bondi Beach. So you bet I'm going to Bondi Beach and walking around. I'm going to buy myself a chicken pie or something, which is, you guys don't have the equivalent to you. For you is kind of like a pot pie, but more like handheld.
It sounds delicious.
I'm excited.
Wait a minute. Lauren, no, do they sell like, let's just call it a pot pie for the sake of.
Sure.
They sell these on the beach? Like you'd eat a pot pie on the beach?
Yeah. Yeah. Everywhere. Like literally down the, yeah, you can buy them everywhere, but the idea of getting, and there's so many different varieties. There's a place out here called Pie Face, and you can get every kind of thing that you can imagine in a pie. They have it all. It's like 20 different things that you can get. So yeah, they're great. And the idea is that they're super, you know, like a handheld size. Right. And you can eat, and it's got pastry on the bottom, which is what I think is kind of missing in the pot pies of America.
Correct.
So it's very cool. Or I might go and get some fish and chips, and that doesn't mean much to you guys, but chips is like fries, but actual fries, where they're thick and they're not
steak.
Like the shoestring stupid
right, steak
things.
Fries.
Steak fries,
those,
right?
Actually,
variation steak fries. So we, exactly. I'm going to get some fish and steak fries.
That sounds
all
great.
The healthy thing because
yeah,
I'm in Australia.
chicken pie. I don't know where you're going.
Yep. No vegetable,
well,
you know, and all
that
fun stuff.
And
thank
enjoy,
you.
Enjoy spending time with the family as well. Nick,
yeah,
what do you got?
You bet.
Oh, it's Christmas kickoff week over here, so it's just mass chaos of family and food and all that.
Right.
I have to figure out
and
some
all time. The wrong eating choices.
Yeah, I gotta figure out a balancing act because we, like I said, we got that live show on New Year's and it's our first one in a little while, and I don't want to look like a.
You're doing a live show on New Year's? I missed that part.
Yeah, San Diego, we're playing.
That's amazing.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah.
There you go.
Congrats.
Thank you.
Great.
Yeah, it should be a lot of fun.
How to escape the wintertime.
For a night, one night only.
Right.
Well, that's your choice because you know my house is empty in LA and I've got keys stashed for you, so, you know, just saying.
God damn it.
Yeah.
Anyway, you want to give us the address? No? Yeah, you guys, thank you for doing that. I'm going to be here on a hour train ride with my boys and Jamie in the lovely state of Delaware. And they have like a special lit up train, like super lit up. Every inch of it's got lights on it. So Mason's brain is sure to explode.
Nice.
So we're going to do that, finish putting up the decorations and, you know, chill.
That sounds great. And we are off this for the next 2 weeks. Is that correct?
Let's take a look at the calendar. Definitely next week.
Definitely next week because it's the day before.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Christmas.
2 weeks. You're right. And then
the
week after that,
day before New Year's. Yeah.
That's a pass, boys and girls.
That's a pass.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, yeah, this has been a great year. You guys.
It has.
Done.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah, it's been great.
Yeah.
This is it. This is like the end of 2021 show. Wow.
Yeah. I would say we're run to best ofs, but I don't even want to open the computer on Friday.
Well, I would suggest that we trail out with our favorite song of the day. Just as a shout out, something
like that.
Fun.
That's a great idea.
There you go.
Yeah. So once again, Dope or Nope, the illustrious panel, Lauren Padman, Vice President of Dimmock Records, Nick from the Disco Fries, Austin Kramer from Tomorrowland's Essentials, and many other things. By the way, follow all these guys on Instagram. It's very important because they're always posting good stuff. Yeah. You need something to do over the holiday.
That's not true.
Watch these guys. They're fucking funny.
I'll post something.
And we are going to leave you with... I'm going to shut off Spotify there for a second. This is Colors.
Big record for 2021.
What label
Please
will
send
this end
to me, Borders.
Where is it going to end up?
Tell me why.
Too loud.
Yeah, it's all right. thanks, everybody. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. Have a great, great holiday. And get some more music together. We'll see you in 2022. Stay safe. This is Colors by Bogus.
Cheers, guys.
Cheers, everybody.
All right, everybody. See ya.
See ya.
Such a dope record. Dope, dope, dope record. Love it. If you guys still are on here on Twitch, thank you guys so much for hanging out, finish my track, and for hanging out with Dope or Nope today. Got some extra noise. Where's that extra noise coming from? Oh, that's Lauren on StreamYard. All right.
Yeah, here I am.
Oh, you're on. You're on.
I have to go, but I just wanted a quick shout out to Alicia because I saw her walking around, and this might be a good time for me to say what's up to her. That was all.
Hey, Alicia.
Hey, Alicia.
She was there. She's gone now.
She's busy.
Just thanking everybody. Thank you guys for having me on Dope or Nope the past couple months. It's been awesome, man.
Great, great addition.
It's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, I love the nerdy banter between us two.
It's
like us helping each other to explain each other, which is great.
I also could watch you and Hess go back and forth forever about
well, true.
Label A&R shit. It's great.
Right.
Pretty much.
Yeah, thank you guys. Really appreciate it. I think we had a good run this year.
Yeah.
You know, we upped the tech game. Thank you, Austin, Nick, for doing it, but also Austin for being so tenacious. Like, we gotta make it.
Yeah.
And Nick just pulled it together.
It was a lot of trial and error there. We got it, though. I still want to figure out the transition between the Finish My Track stream and this stream. I got to, like, create, like, a bumper, something to, like, hey, we're going this to that. And it's, like, an intro. But we'll get it.
Right.
New year.
Right.
New bumpers.
Exactly.
New year, new bumpers.
New year, new bumpers.
So while you guys are still on here, I'm going to plug it one more time. We're doing a virtual event next Wednesday, the 22nd at 8 p.m. You got a RSVP. Here's the RSVP link. Jump in.
Is that
there.
The one with the graphic?
That is the one with the graphic. Yep. So it'll be a good time. 8 p.m. next Wednesday. Have some special guests on. We're going to do some giveaways. And it's going to be a lot of fun. You can have some cocktails. You could eat dinner during it. Doesn't matter to us. It's all good.
Right. Doesn't matter to you. It's like, hey, put that cocktail down. I hate myself.
Exactly.
All right, we're going to raid into our friend Stash here on Twitch. She is live right now. Killer DJ and performer. And
I just want to let you guys know that I'm in the future. It's Saturday morning.
That always
bugs
me out.
Just wanted to let you know that Saturday's pretty good. So you've got something to look forward to.
Oh, good.
I thought I would help
I
you
want to make sure...
That.
It's worth getting up.
It is worth getting up. Listen, I'll show you real quick. Look,
see? That's Saturday out there, see?
Wow. Amazing.
Guys, we're in the future.
Saturday's everywhere out here. Look at it. It's just Saturday. Beautiful.
Very nice.
You'll like it. You'll be impressed with Saturday. I highly recommend it.
Amazing.
Yeah. All right, guys. I'm out.
Guys, appreciate you.
Love you all.
Peace.
Take care.
Take care, guys.